Attention. The movie guys love movies. Any comments about how people are a bit too quick to be abnormally angry are purely for entertainment purposes only. Isn't that right?
Whoa, 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 whoa. I'll tell you what isn't right. Apple Big Brothering me a new U2 album for free? How dare they? How dare they? What do you want, a thank you? And he's down with the Ice Bucket Challenge. We're having a drought. How dare you? And Affleck is Batman? I will kill everybody if they actually release this movie. And there's no singing in the Into the Woods trailer. There's no singing!
I've got to get out of here.
Calm down. Get a hold of yourself.
Stewardess, please, let me handle this.
I've got to get out of here.
Calm down. Now get back to your seat.
Who gives a shit?
Wait a minute. I don't think I have the U2 album.
Did you download the new iTunes?
Oh, yeah. No.
Or the new OS?
I think they just stick it on your phone, don't they?
How are they scamming you with this?
We have to have it on the iCloud.
It's in the cloud. It's automatically in the cloud.
Right.
So and then you just, if you want to, download it onto your phone. If you can listen to it
in the cloud. No, I think it's on your phone, people have told me.
Because you can listen to it on the cloud.
No, I thought you had to download either a new OS or a new app of some sort.
I was all caught up, so mine must be automatically up.
Yeah, there's a button or a thing you can click on that you agree to something, and then that's why it comes on automatically on your iTunes. But if you haven't clicked that button, that's why you don't have it.
I don't think I have it. How would I know? Would it be under albums?
So, like, we'll give you stuff, but we're not going to force it on you.
There might be a music podcast where we can cover all this.
Oh, sorry. Hi.
Well, that's the music guys.
This is the Movie Showcast, everybody, part of the vast and sprawling Movie Guys Empire. You know, some people play hard to get. I play hard to want. You've reached ground zero for all things movies and comedy. We bring the two together right here on our show every week with jokes, rants, sketches, characters, Bix.
Did you flick
Bic
it?
Razors. Special guests
they
and
just
more.
Show up for free in your shower.
As we broadcast from the Admiral's Club, where that hum you hear is the air conditioning. They don't stop making movies, so we don't stop making comedy shows about movies, which means you can get a new show from us every week. Basically, search The Movie Guys or The Movie Showcast anywhere in the worldwide webs and Googles, and we come right up. iTunes, SoundCloud, YouTube, Stitcher, and of course, themovieguys.net, absolutely free. And we encourage you to subscribe wherever you can, and if you do, still, no charge. You can find our showcasts like the one you're listening to on a couple of internet radio stations as well, including WBAD.net Fridays at 4 p.m. Eastern and JonasMountRadio.com Thursdays at 6, who, last I looked, are also not charging. I'm your host for the hardest working podcast on the airwaves, Paul Preston, here with Lee Caius and Karen Volpe. And later in the show, we'll be joined by this week's guest, one of the great improvisers to come out of the Second City scene, currently performing, where you can catch them with Beer Shark Mice, and an accomplished actor who's appeared on some of the biggest TV shows out there, including Friends, Seinfeld, The Drew Carey Show, Curb Your Enthusiasm, and more, as well as films like It's Complicated and I Love You, Beth Cooper, Pat Finn.
Yeah!
Pat Finn.
That is just a small piece of the stuff he's done.
We have a string of Irishmen.
Yeah.
Wasn't Pat Gardner?
Pete Gardner. Is he Irish?
I thought he was.
I don't know.
He wasn't Italian.
No.
He wasn't wearing green. So how would we know? Also, Adam is out this week. He went to the wedding of a friend of the show, Kate James. So, happiness to Kate.
Couldn't talk her out of it. I mean, congratulations.
Congratulations, Kate.
But speaking of special guests, one of our former guests takes up the Adam chair as John Rocha joins us for the whole show.
Hello, everybody.
John, whatever happens, this is a great intro, but whatever happens when the show is over, don't let me thank you for being here and appearing on the show.
Don't forget
it's not
thank
necessary.
Him.
Okay.
It's,
good. Am I off the hook?
You can thank me now.
Okay, good.
You don't thank me at the end.
Outstanding.
No. We'll focus on Pat Finn at the end.
Yeah, you know, he might just fit in so much you figured he's there.
Right. That's another way.
John's going to help us preview what's coming up this weekend in theaters, because that's what we do.
Hoo-ah.
This includes another chapter in the long-running saga, Liam Neeson Can't Catch a Goddamn Break, with A Walk in the Tombstones. And then, is it a movie, or is it a call to action for Janae Rice? This is where I leave you. But first...
What's through there?
You guys can't just keep me here.
I can't let you leave.
Why won't you tell me what's out there?
That's the maze.
Ooh, yes, the Maze Runner. A Walk Among the Tombstones, and This Is Where I Leave You. That's this week at the movies. You can run, walk, or leave. Those are your choices.
I will be doing all of those.
Right when I said it was like Man Month and we had Idris Elba and Liam Neeson, here come a bunch of kids jumping around a labyrinth.
And you know what's funny? I would rather see them do it. I want to see Idris Elba and Liam Neeson and some other adult jump on that maze.
We have jumped ahead of the demographic for this movie.
I just can't believe how many books I am not aware of.
Yeah.
Right. Yeah. Every time they're a movie, I'm like,
we've crossed an age. We don't go backwards.
Like, yeah. You don't go back and read the young adult stuff or the 20-year-olds. It doesn't appeal to us.
I remember the first day it was a genre in the Barnes & Noble.
Yeah.
Barnes & Noble, for the kids out there, was a bookstore that contained paper-bound books.
No, clearly they know this. Where right.
They're the ones getting the
right
books.
Buying the books.
Where yeah. are the kids getting these books?
Oh, the kids.
Kindle.
The damn kids. Take they, it.
I mean, are these all on the Kindles?
Yeah, Bob, sure.
You know why the kids are doing the book reading is because they're annoying if they don't have anything to do. So when the parents are driving in the car or else eating at a restaurant, they just take the electric thing and put it in front of the kids and say, right. read that shit.
Why don't they just put like a bookshelf in the back of the Escalade instead of screens in the headrests?
There you go.
The kids are like, wow, look at this new technology. It's a thing
it's
that
a
holds a
book.
Book. It's like a magazine rack at the dentist
you
office.
You know, on my iPhone, there's a little app that looks like a bookshelf
yeah,
that has
exactly.
phone slash books in it.
That is the snake eating its tail, isn't it? When somebody has their iPhone set to ring like an old-timey bell.
Yeah,
wow. Have
a
we
phone.
Really mm-hmm. folded in on ourselves that way?
Yeah.
Here's a digital version of a thing that already existed.
Yeah.
Ringing.
I saw a girl walking down the street. It was the greatest thing. She had her iPhone, and she had this earpiece that came out of the top. Went up into a regular full-size handheld old-timey phone. So she was able to hold the receiver, and she walked down the busy street, and she was talking. It was a pink one like you would get on a phone, an actual phone.
So it
and
fit
it
her
hooked
big
into
receiver.
The top. It
that
was a big receiver.
Brilliant.
And she was just walking and talking, and I went, there you go.
That
and I bet
hilarious.
She could hear fine, and I bet they could hear her.
Right. Yep.
Now that everyone under 30 has turned off the show,
yeah.
we can move forward, I guess. Oh, I should mention, speaking of under 30, though, we have joined for the first time in studio, Kristen Stewart
Ooh.
Standee.
Yay!
We have a standee. For those of you watching the YouTube version of the show, Kristen Stewart's standee is here. And she's just as skinny as the real thing, I
yep,
believe.
Yep, absolutely.
She snuck up on me.
That's
there,
a young. That's a Twilight one. That's like first Twilight, right? That's like 08.
You know
it's
how many creepy men are laying in bed with that thing? You know what's happened.
Not this one.
Well, it definitely has happened.
Yeah, yeah. And no, not with the one we have in the studio. That's creepy. No. Just saying.
Wait, listen closely. She's saying something.
I'm late. My period's late.
No, that's a later Twilight movie, I guess.
What?
That's not what I would say if I was addressing the Admiral's Club for the first time,
no.
but that's what she chose to say. Wait, listen quietly.
I don't mind coconuts.
Oh, she likes coconuts. So you write
I don't
that
mind
down.
Coconuts.
So you guys with the flat Kristen Stewart in your bed, bring coconuts. She likes coconuts.
She doesn't mind them.
Oh, and just for fun, remember when we strung together, or we didn't do it, but we played it because some guy online had more time than we did. All the times Colin Firth stuttered in the
yes,
King's speech.
Yes, I like that. Mm-hmm.
Apparently, one of Kristen Stewart's strong acting assets is her ability to, like, breathe in and sigh and mouth breathe. And,
sure.
yeah, and someone strung all of those together.
Oh,
some of her best work.
Oh, my God.
And those aren't porns? I feel like she's asthmatic.
Well, help her. Somebody help her.
Right. She needs an inhaler.
Oh, there's that.
She trapped under something heavy?
Oh, I don't think Kristen liked that. What did you say, Kristen?
I think that it's fairly rare when you find a female protagonist that is not sort of just doing a lame interpretation of a, like impression of a guy.
Oh, defending herself.
Oh.
Right. Well,
very articulate point there.
Oh. Mm. Okay. Well, you can stick around then. I did like
okay.
that. All right.
She's far more eloquent than I thought.
Yes.
Given yeah. her almost two-dimensional.
It's as lifelike as you would find her.
Sexy. Very
all right,
sexy.
Well, one thing all this week's releases have in common is that they are adapted from novels, making this our first ever three-film based on a book week. There you go. It's... Oh, yes. I was clapping too hard. You have to clap the hard part of your... hand very lightly. Hollywood thinks it's pretty smart. Let's see how it does. Our first film, based on a book, sounds like Liam Neeson taking a stroll through the frozen pizza aisle.
Ooh.
But it's actually a hard-boiled thriller. A Walk Among the Tombstones.
Terrible.
Lee, let's talk about it.
Oh, that other music made me feel smarter, Paul. This is...
I know.
Okay.
Now I feel dopey again. Don't like black people?
Well...
Then try The Equalizer with Liam Neeson.
Now, if you don't recognize the title, that's because the working name was changed from some slightly less morose titles like A Stroll Amongst the Concentration Camps and A Sachet Betwixt the Amputees.
Private investigator Matthew Scudder is hired by a drug kingpin to find out who kidnapped his wife, starring Liam Neeson.
Paul, I submit to you that this may be the most complete movie description ever offered. Every question you may have about this movie is answered in that description.
Who's in it?
Liam Neeson.
What's it about?
Liam Neeson kicking ass. See, everything you want to know is right there.
There you go. Yeah. Now, with a serial killer's unrelenting search to track down a murderer woman, this movie looks to be as dark as its title. But just remember, every time the daily news gets you down, remember no Liam Neeson movie could exist without all this bad news.
Now, it is important to keep clear the distinction here that Liam Neeson is an ex-cop turned private investigator.
This is Jim Rockford. At the tone, leave your name and message. Ooh, I'll get back to you.
Actually, I'm sorry, Lee. No, it's not that kind of private investigator.
Sorry.
It's this kind of private investigator.
So you're a private detective.
Unlicensed. I do favors for people. In return, they give me gifts.
Ah, that kind of private investigator.
Yes, let me see if the movie can successfully explain the difference between a private investigator and a cop.
Why aren't you a cop no more?
You see, one shot, well, the bullet took a bad hop.
I get it, movie. Kill someone as a police officer, feel guilty about it because you were on duty. Kill someone as a private investigator, no big thing as there's no threat to job security. Thanks, movie!
It's all about the pension.
Yeah.
Now, Paul, if you listen carefully to the trailer, there's actually a voice cameo by Vin Diesel.
Oh.
People are afraid of all the wrong things.
Oh. That guy does kind of growl, doesn't he?
No reason to stay. Wasn't hiding. That's the deal. Take it or leave it.
Is he another Austin?
Oh, and huzzah!
Yes.
We have a new sound effect to induct into the Hall of Bong. Named after the Transformers franchise. Let's listen to Bong for a second here, shall we? All remember Bong?
Oh. He's a classic.
That was Battleship Bong. Here's Transformers Bong.
He did change it up there. He's rangy.
Yeah. And here, you remember, of course, remember that one?
Oh, Brrrr, yeah.
There it goes. Well, this summer we got the new trailer sound from Transformers Age of Extinction when we got Brrrr.
Yes.
And yes, so good. Paul,
Dinobots.
Amongst all those greats, please welcome to the Hall of Bong, a popular sound in the trailer for A Walk Among the Tombstones.
Yeah.
Oh.
See,
good.
Blending the subtlety of a zipper with the intensity of a lawnmower about to start makes the perfect addition to any creepy movie trailer. Congratulations.
Oh. I'm so excited. This is great. Now, between Idris Elba last week and Neeson, again, I have to reiterate, we've entered the time of year when real men put out movies. I mean, Neeson's a man. He does grown man things.
Yeah, I'm a grown man. I do grown man things.
I love that.
Let's listen to one more clip.
I was off duty one day in this bar in Washington Heights. The cops didn't have to pay for their drinks.
And with one sentence, Liam Neeson shatters every belief I've ever had about police officers.
Oh, yeah.
They're hanging out in the bar where they don't have to pay for their drinks.
Well, I don't think they have to pay for their donuts either, right?
Probably not.
Yeah,
so they're all hammered. That's great. Thanks, movies. I'm learning a lot from the movies this week.
From the movies, yeah. You know, here's one thing I learned from this preview is that what would be fun is you take your iPhone and put on the ring from the Rockford Files because it has the old-timey ring, and then it goes, I can't come to the phone right now. That'd be a great ring, right?
I love that idea.
I know. Thank you.
What I love about this movie with Liam Neeson is that this is a movie with Liam Neeson in which somebody gets taken. See what I did there?
I loved what you did there.
Because he made two of those.
It's a good connection.
Yeah.
This is a Scott Frank movie. Now, if you follow Scott Frank at all, he wrote Get Shorty. Uh-huh. He wrote Out of Sight.
Out of Sight.
I think I followed Paul Frank.
So he's got
he has the, cute little socks yeah. and monkeys.
So he's got these hard as nails dramas, and I think Neeson's right for this kind of thing.
Right.
If he stops screwing
great.
Around with his nonstops and all that.
That's right for this kind of drama. Right. Yeah.
I love it, John. That's great.
We've taken my wife. You've taken my friend's wife. Yeah.
Tell us to watch the movie guys.
This is Liam Neeson. Telling you to watch the movie guys.
That's nice. Thank you.
I've contracted AIDS.
From an African prostitute.
She was riddled with it.
She was riddled with it.
Selling her body was the only
way. That was great.
There's a bunch of wolves out there.
You think he'd take, he like, when they say, we got a script for you, Liam.
Do I take a phone call in it?
Like, you think that's probably a...
He only reads, like, the first 10 pages, and he's looking, just scanning. He's just scanning, when's a phone, there's no direction for phone, no.
All right, so here's a book.
Yes.
Not young adult book.
Thank goodness.
But have you heard of it?
No.
What?
Yeah, I don't fly a lot,
this
though.
Is not young. Okay, yeah, no.
Not young adult.
I never heard of Jack Reacher, and that knocked my socks off. So yeah. I've,
you know
what?
That's not called that.
Huh? It,
that wasn't called that. That was called, like, One Shot or
oh.
something.
Oh.
You yeah. know what? I yeah. just realized what the deal is. Maybe in L.A. we don't hear of a lot of these books. One, because we're in L.A. Two, we don't go on public transportation. When I lived in Chicago, I read a lot more books.
That's a good point.
Because I was on the train. And you can't, like, listen. You can't even use your phone a lot of times if you go underground. So people read the paper or they actually read a book.
But I would counter and say we lay on the beach a lot. So there's
you might.
have you tried to read at the beach?
I'm pale.
It's tough. All the time. Oh, really?
I think that's too bright.
You have an umbrella?
Oh, no.
You have an umbrella?
Of course I have.
Yeah, you got
yeah,
an umbrella.
Of course. I burn quickly. I'm Latino. It's
you
I
mean, have
half
perfect
an hour.
Skin. Are you kidding?
Half
I'm a
an hour
pale.
Inside, and then you're after that, you're burnt. So, yeah.
And I, but I haven't read this. I get to a book like once a year.
I've movie seen guy, them.
You know?
Interesting.
I've seen it on people's shelves and homes.
So L.A. You're so L.A. Lee.
Listen, watching all these movies that I watch, rule number one is a kidnapper. If you call the victim's family and Liam Neeson answers, just hang up. It's a problem with these guys. They keep talking to him.
I understand we have a new player in the game.
Yeah, damn straight there's a new player in the game. His name is Liam Neeson. Hang up. We've heard this before.
I don't know who you are. I don't know what you want.
See, this is... Look, the reason the wolves did so well in The Gray is that they didn't call ahead. Trust me, nothing good ever happens when Liam Neeson gets on the phone.
Hello, Little Tony's. Pick up or delivery.
Look, I don't know who you are.
This is Little Tony.
I don't know what you want.
Well, I'd like you to try our two large pizza special.
If you're looking to kidnap my daughter, I can tell you I have no money.
I didn't kidnap your daughter. I've got two pizzas for $16.99. Do you have $16.99?
What I do have is a particular hunger for cheese and sauce.
Well, then you've come to the right place. And two toppings are included.
A hunger I've acquired during a very long football pregame show.
Okay, I got a lot of calls. So, what toppings do you want on the pizzas?
I have a hunger for pepperoni that makes me a nightmare for people like you.
So, is that double pepperoni? Because we've got meat lovers. You know, I can give you two of those for $16.99.
Now, I want you to listen very close. I have an allergy to sausage. An allergy that makes it a nightmare for my acid reflux.
Okay, so just double pepperoni.
If you send a double pepperoni and black olives to 1498 Cross Canyon Road now, that'll be the end of it.
Okay, but that's an extra topping.
I will not look for a better deal. I will not pursue a better deal.
I got a charger for the extra topping.
But if you don't, I will call Papa John's. I will find the extra pepperoni I seek. And I will eat the shit out of it.
Well, with the extra topping, it only comes to $19.99, and that's still for two pizzas.
And I will kill you.
All right, I'm just trying to make a living here, okay? I don't need threats.
Where is my daughter?
Look, I didn't kidnap your daughter. It's her shift. She's just working her shift. Give me a break and stop calling.
Put her on the phone.
Hi, Dad.
I need you to listen very carefully. Here's what's going to happen next. You're going to ask for Easter off.
I had to pick Easter or Good Friday. I'm on the schedule.
Excuse me. Hey, buddy, we've got a lot of calls here. I can't give all of my employees the holiday off.
Her grandmother is very sick. If you give her Easter off, that'll be the end of it.
You've got to ask for it in advance. You know what? I'm hanging up.
The rotary phone.
Right?
Citibank.
Look, I don't know who you are, but what I need is a particular line of credit. If you give me checking plus with overdraft protection, that'll be the end of it.
There you go. Liam Neeson orders a
day in the life of.
Yeah, I love that he's just ready to make phone calls. He's like, all right.
You know, thing.
I don't really know phone numbers anymore, but Liam Neeson does. He's using a rotary phone. Yeah. He's got that shit memorized.
Even on the plane and nonstop, he's texting.
He's old school.
Get off the phone.
He's playing for the big plan up there. I mean, It's tough to get service. All right, next up, it's time to play Is It a Movie?
Oops, sorry.
Yay!
Welcome to Is It a Movie, where this week we look at The Maze Runner and ask the vital questions and see if it has checked off everything on the Hollywood blockbuster checklist.
Good.
Here we go. Is it set in a post-apocalyptic time? Oh, there you go. Are teens in jeopardy of being killed? Oh, good. There you go. And is it based on a book? Well, of course it is. As Based on a Book Week continues.
Yes.
All right, Karen, let's preview The Maze Runner. Here we go.
Tired of adapting complex video games, the producers of The Maze Runner have gone back to life's original video game, Getting Lost.
The Maze Runner is adapted from the Big Boy placement activity. This is just the beginning for adaptations of Simple Activities. Coming soon, Word Find.
Ooh.
The story of 12 teens in a life-or-death struggle to find out if deflagonate is a word or not. And Sudoku, the story of one divorced uncle trying to eat up time in a dentist's waiting room.
But what's the plot of The Maze Runner? A bunch of people are stuck in a maze, they climb to the top, and they get out that way. The end.
No, wait, there's more to it than that. A young man named Thomas is deposited in a community of boys.
Jealous.
After his memory is erased.
Well, he's young, it shouldn't take that long.
But the erasers conveniently leave in the memories of how to breathe, panic, and run.
It's a movie, isn't it?
He soon learns that they are all trapped in a maze that will require him to join forces with the other runners if he ever hopes to escape.
See, now this plot description doesn't tell you anything.
No?
Does Liam Neeson star in it? Does he kick ass? I have a feeling none of these questions are going to be answered the way I would like.
Reading just the first three of the 27 paragraphs Wikipedia has explaining the plot to this book makes you glad they turned it into a movie.
It should be noted, however, that the Wikipedia entry for the film version has only one paragraph describing the plot. Once again, movies win. Take that, books!
I do know this. Between The Hunger Games, The Giver, Divergent, and now The Maze Runner, the future hates teenagers.
Right? Is this how teens see the world? It used to be that all adults wanted to do was stifle a kid's creativity, individuality, and desire to express themselves. But apparently outlawing dancing wasn't working. So now we've decided to just kill them.
Absolutely. In 1985, these kids would have just ended up in detention, flirting with each other and smoking pot. Now there's danger.
We got something eating like this, Granny.
Get off.
All right, calm.
No, okay. Why won't you tell me what's out there?
Just trying to protect you, man.
But I love it already.
You guys can't just keep me here.
We can't let you leave.
This movie
Why
I want
not?
To see.
This is way better.
The film stars a host of actors with names that sound like poets, including Dylan O'Brien, John Langston, Dexter Darden, and
true.
Will Poulter, who doesn't look like Matt Damon, but looks like Jesse Plemons, who does. And whom we've called nice. Fake Matt Damon. Mm-hmm. So it's safe to say The Maze Runner stars fake Matt Damon.
The film also co-stars Caius Clodaria in the Kristen Stewart role.
Please, get out of here. I mean, know what I'm doing.
This is based on the best-selling novel by James Dashner. The screenplay for the film was written by Noah Oppenheim, Grant Pierce Meyer, and T.S. Nowlin. So, let's see, that's 1, 2, 3 writers to write something that's already been written. Well, you've been warned.
There you go. That's going to be your box office winner, though. Goof as we might. Liam will come strong. I think these Maze Runner kids will probably win. Right?
I got to write one of these best-selling books.
Absolutely.
That seems to be step one.
Right.
Step one is write a best-selling book.
Yeah, and then it's all cake
That's
after that.
All.
How long is your plan?
Well, I think part of, this is just me guessing, but part of the reason Maze Runner and movies like that do better is because adults have jobs.
Mm. Please to explain.
Well, adults go to work for most of the day,
and
teenagers don't have anything to do. So they go to school and then go to like band practice and then go to the movies. And their parents are like, just get the hell out of the house, go to another movie.
I've said this before about the movie, guys. One of the joys of it is we preview every movie that comes out.
Right.
But we only see the ones we want.
the Liam Neeson
movie.
So
we'll talk about everything, but, you know, when it comes down to do we have to go and see...
Right.
Let's put John in charge of Maze Runner, because he went to see I, Frankenstein.
But I'm going to counter you on that.
What?
This is a week I want to see everything. I'd see the Maze Runner.
Really?
I would if you kept playing...
I saw the Octagon.
Don't you forget about me.
Same shit, bunch of people running through a maze.
But Chuck Norris!
Yeah!
That makes it better!
Not as good as any of these kids, I can guarantee you.
I don't think they're going to make any kind of t-shirts based on any sayings from any of these kids like they did for Chuck Norris.
That's true.
Lost there.
And Conan.
What was that review you had?
Dylan O'Brien is so tough, he pushes the world away from him. That's not going to happen. What's what?
No, you were saying, what bunch of kids run around? Well, good for them. They need the exercise. Yeah. fat teens.
My dad's for a movie review.
I'm sorry. I want to just kind of peel back the curtain here. We have some bullet points here.
Oh, yeah. What is
that? Oh, yeah.
I see one that is making me laugh, and I don't know how to set it up.
Okay,
can you guess which one it is?
If we made a movie about a maze, we'd want to put a Minotaur in it, right? Right.
That's what I thought, yeah.
What would we name the Minotaur?
Pat Minotaur.
Pat Minotaur?
Oh, because of Pat Benatar. Thanks, oh, my Gary, God. Wait a minute. I made that stupid comment when we were doing the thing. Oh, shit. You guys actually wrote it down.
Careful what you say in the writing meetings. They will end up.
Pat Minotaur.
I just saw the words Pat Minotaur.
But yes. As I might, there was no joke to be had.
No, except
that's what
for
we had to
Pat Minotaur.
We had to mention.
Joke.
Yeah.
You can't do better than Pat Minotaur.
Thank you, John.
Well, that's
Thank
really
you.
Good.
Oh my God, I forget. How sad.
If the effects are cool in this movie and the walls are shifting and the ground's flying up and all that stuff, I'll see this.
I've read the plot and I've seen two or three trailers and I can't quite figure out what the deal is.
I don't think you're supposed to.
Okay.
The whole deal is...
Mission accomplished.
Like, that's end of movie, I have a feeling. He'll, arrive at a place and, you know, Willy Wonka will tell him.
Because it looks like they go in, come out, maybe not.
We're going in an elevator.
I just figured out the one thing that would make this movie great.
Boobs.
And... Jack Nicholson.
Oh, my
because
God.
The last time I saw a Maze movie, and it was scary as shit.
Oh, yeah.
Jack Nicholson was involved.
You missed Labyrinth, huh?
Come here. Yeah, I didn't see that.
Come here, Danny.
But you know, yeah, right. And he's all kind of fucked up, and he's going through the maze, and the kids
I hope he's
walking
in there.
Backwards in the snow.
Yeah, I hope he's
Come
in there.
Here,
I hope Pat Minotaur comes around the corner, and she's snorting some hot air out her nose, and she's dressed like a little prostitute in that one video.
Love is a battlefield.
Hit me with your best shot. Yeah.
Love is a battlefield, Jack.
No, I've read several plot descriptions, both to the book and to the movie on Wikipedia, and saw several trailers, and it really does look very... First of all, every plot description I've read says Thomas wakes up not having any memory of how he got there, which, thank you for sparing me whatever happened before, because I don't need to see it, but it also seems kind of like a lazy way to start your movie. Forget about the backstory. Here's where we are.
But that's the thing. I think if they describe who Thomas is more in the description of the movie, it's probably giving something away later in the film.
And that's the perfect way to start a Saturday morning. Waking up where you don't know what the
hell is going on.
And then Pat Minotaur is sleeping next to you. You're like, what happened?
What the hell happened this Friday night? Yeah.
Well,
I just have a bad feeling this movie is trying to trick me into seeing it by leaving so many questions unanswered that I just have to go.
They don't even tell you that there's free money handed out to the audience when it's over.
Exactly.
They keep that under wraps.
And I also want to mention, I just went to the Halloween Horror Nights preview, so that's opening next week at Universal here in Hollywood.
Mm-hmm.
And I love it. I love Not Scary Farm, also a big thing that I go to every year here in Southern California, where they just turn the whole theme park into a big scare zone. But Halloween Horror Nights is cool because it's all movies, so naturally the movie guy, I love it.
Yeah.
And this year, they nailed it with Aliens vs. Predator Maze.
Oh,
I was worried. I'm like, this is going to require a lot of stuff. You can't just put a guy in a sheet and have him go, rawr. You know, you really got to build some stuff. Well, that's where Universal wins. They build stuff. The sets look great. The monsters look great. That's a new maze this year that you want to check out. But who's dropping the ball in marketing to not have a Maze Runner maze? These are horror mazes. We need a Maze Runner.
Would Universal be able to do that? Is that their property?
No, it's not. But, you know, they're building Harry Potter Land to celebrate Warner Brothers' great film franchise.
Mm.
So, I don't get why they...
Next year they'll do
but
it.
But anywhere, you know?
Yeah.
Why didn't Maze Runner talk to Six Flags and go... Let's do this.
You know what? We have a lot and a half here in Burbank because we're right on the edge of the road. We could put one right in the back. You, me, Maze Runner. You, me, and
the
dog
garage.
Behind the garage. All we need are a couple of trash bags, right? And some wood.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. And John will come over and make that creepy sound, like talk real low and scary.
Absolutely. Are you committing crimes or celebrating Halloween?
We're cleaning up a crime scene.
Both. Plastic bag and some wood.
Take a left.
All right, let's get to our final new film of the weekend.
Wait, I'm going to have Pat Minotaur chasing people.
Feel free.
I'm never going to, no. What? Like, this genre is done, isn't it? Like, we've seen Beautiful Creatures, we've seen all these. None of them have, like, only...
Well, maybe you've seen
I think I like this one
because... Speak for yourself!
I certainly didn't.
I walked into that one. Wham! Is that a rake? No, I'm seeing, like, this seems played out, this whole genre, because they start these things, but they don't really catch on. None of them have really caught on enough to do a second one.
The reason I give this one a second chance is because it's not Hunger Games is good, but the world it lives in is really weird, right? And then the other ones that you mentioned all have mythical sort of otherworldly creatures.
Yeah, like Percy Jackson and the Olympian, whatever
it
was.
Yeah, it's like weird. This is just like sci-fi maze, that's all, I think.
I guess.
I don't know.
Well, Divergent was like that, and that didn't do that well, right?
No.
Well, this is Lord of the Flies.
Yeah, did it do okay?
Lord of the Flies meets Running Man.
You think they'll all turn against each other?
I'll be back. Only in rerun.
Yeah. Mm. Well, in the sense that they have to get through the maze, it's Running Man.
Yeah.
I don't know. Well, it says in the description, must work together in order to escape. So.
Maybe I'm not going to go. John, you're turning me around.
It's not my demographic.
Because I wouldn't normally go. And I thought I was going out on the edge of a tree branch here.
Well, you go with Lee. You guys can go.
I just want to say that I learned another thing from this, not only about the phone app and having that be my ringer, but I also think maybe for Halloween I'll be Pat Minotaur.
Oh, brilliant.
Wouldn't that be fun?
This is so amazing.
Mm-hmm, sure.
So what would that look like? So the bottom half would be a horse, and then you just have a big mouthful of teeth with a bushy haircut?
Yeah, I'd get that short, crappy haircut. Mm-hmm. I'd put on the half-prostitute outfit, and then I'd have horns, but I'd have that little pixie cut.
Pat Minotaur.
And then I'd have, like, legs like a horse, and then I would just dance like this.
The whole time. Just walk into the party.
Yeah.
Just walk in.
Battlefield.
No, perfect.
It'd be kind of amazing.
All right, so listen, onto our final film. This is where I leave you. John and I are going to talk about it in our ongoing episode of Based on a Book Week.
We should just leave. This is where we leave you. Goodbye.
Did you see a bit written on the screen?
That's three for three of the movies based on a book. So, which means literacy wins and spec writers in Hollywood lose. Here we go. Based on a Book Week continues with This Is Where I Leave You. But before you rush out to your local airport bookstore during your layover in Denver, be forewarned, the book doesn't star Jason Bateman. Stupid book.
Well, don't like a bunch of Jews, but want to see a Jewish movie? Well, try the cast of This Is Where I Leave You.
This charm offensive of a cast includes Bateman, Adam Driver, Corey Stoll, and Tina Fey, who plays the bossy pants sister, who's really a modern-day Mo from the Three Stooges.
I'm Wendy Altman, bitch. Yeah, that's a princess cut.
Hitting people and whatnot.
And the great Catherine Hahn, one of Hollywood's premier go-to actresses for comedic supporting roles, finally makes the jump to the poster.
Oh, I love that. She's hilarious.
She's poster quality.
Sometimes trailers to movies can be a little cryptic, not wanting to reveal much about the plot. Instead, they tease the audience with seemingly random clips of action and dialogue that don't begin to hint at the actual premise. Maze Runner.
Yeah.
Oh, yes, trailers can be mysterious.
Dad's dead. Your father had one final request, and we are going to honor it.
He just wanted his kids under one roof. So for the next 7 days, you are all grounded.
This is not one of those trailers.
This is a movie that's not just about laughs, but also about people learning about life, love, and happiness, which I'm usually not into. But it speaks to the power of this cast that I'd watch them do even that.
Shiva me timbers. Finally, here comes a movie about the great Jewish tradition of spending 7 days focusing on sadness. It's just one of the many Jewish traditions focusing on sadness, including Passover and growing up Jewish.
Upper-class white people have problems too, you know. And here's a movie that proves it.
3 months ago, I had a great job and a nice apartment, and I was in love with my wife.
I know. What a nightmare. But all kidding aside, This Is Where I Leave You, a great double feature with If I Stay. By the way, is a movie that goes where other coming-of-age family-based comedies fear to tread, not using Salisbury Hill in its soundtrack to signify when things are going to start to get on the mend.
Mm-hmm. I feel better already.
Yeah. I do.
I want to see this movie.
Yeah.
Brave choice movie. Brave choice.
Now, once again, it would seem as though Jason Bateman was given all the best lines. And by that, of course, we mean that any line Jason Bateman delivers is the best.
Oh, mother, those are not the same breasts you nursed us with. She slept with my boss.
We made love on our first date.
Mom.
I don't mind telling you, the man was hung.
That should have been the headstone.
Clearly she lost more than a husband. Yeah. It's a circle of life, everybody. Let's go, Altman's.
He's great.
LaVille jumps from premise to premise. Hey, let's have all the adult children be grounded in the same house for a week.
Hey, let's show the brothers who can't maintain a decent relationship.
No, we're going to tell four different stories at once about everyone.
It's a rather indecisive motion picture. Makes sense that it's being released on the cusp of Libra. Ooh. There you go. Good old horoscope joke to go out on.
During the end of that, I went to look at the poster because I wanted to see what you're talking about, how the girl, that one actress, finally made the poster. Everybody made the poster.
Right. Not
they
Connie.
Have the pizza delivery guy in here. Everybody's in this poster.
Not Connie Britton.
Oh,
wait,
that's right.
Really? One person didn't make it?
Yeah. Unless that's her. They get them confused.
Oh. Anyway.
Connie Britton's good light, bad light, right?
I think she's in the back there, Connie Britton. All the way back in the left.
Yeah,
what
right?
There's good a light, bad light.
Ton of people in this picture.
I've seen her look amazing, and then I've seen her look, ooh, hey, now, easy.
That's acting. She's got range.
Oh, that's a
yes.
Okay.
Don't pick on her.
Did you ever see Monster? Come on.
That's true.
Is Tina Fey a movie star? That's a question I want to ask.
They're certainly trying to make me think so. But she hasn't carried a film on her own, has she?
Oh, Admission.
Date Night? Admission, I mean, they've been released. They haven't. You know.
Admission didn't make anything. Date Night was middling, I think, money-wise.
Yeah. Yeah. But Baby Mama?
Baby Mama was great, but that's her and Amy Poehler.
Yeah.
And people are going to run to that, especially now.
Yeah.
You know, even more so now since they've done the Golden Globes and
Love her.
Yeah.
But I wonder if she's a movie star. You know, she won the Mark Twain Comedy Prize, the youngest person ever to do it.
Because she's a great comedy writer.
She's a great comedy writer.
Well,
but,
Katherine Heigl couldn't write a comedy. She wouldn't get the Mark Twain Comedy Prize. No. And I don't consider her a movie star.
No.
Katherine Heigl.
Not anymore.
So I would give Tina Fey at least a little more credit because she can at least write the funny shit that comes out of her face.
Definitely.
But Eddie Murphy hasn't won the Mark Twain Prize. Neither has Mel Brooks.
I feel like you...
slow down. Mel Brooks hasn't won it?
That's what I'm saying.
I want to stick up for my sister, though, and be like, yay, Tina Fey!
Well, she's amazing. But
right?
Yeah. I'm just saying.
She doesn't open a movie, though.
No.
Mel Brooks isn't a movie star either, though. He does funny movies.
Yeah, come now.
But he doesn't open a movie right now.
It matters. He's a movie franchise. Like he.
But he's no Matthew McConaughey.
Mel Brooks movie is a genre.
Look, if you're gonna say come now, cue the master scholarly music, please. Come now.
I'm just trying to figure out what
your tone. I will not be scoffed.
I am trying to understand what exactly are your qualifications. Are we saying someone who isn't a movie that we like to look at? Or are we saying someone who
just saying that
is
love
young? What are we saying? All right.
I'm taking back everything.
This wouldn't count either way because it's an ensemble movie, right?
So there you go.
It's not
Boom.
Her movie.
Yeah.
That's just what drives me nuts sometimes when they say certain actresses or actors have made, their movies have made billions, and you look at most of them are ensemble movies. It should not count on your credit. It
because
be
you get all
guy.
Of the pull from every
right.
star that's in the movie.
Exactly.
Who's the biggest movie star with that frame of mind?
Aniston.
Intact. No, the biggest movie star?
That has that qualification thrown on her?
Same.
If you look
Male, too, anybody.
Oh, male.
Yeah, yeah.
Well, maybe like
it's
Steve
Samuel
Carell.
Jackson. It's Samuel
oh,
Jackson.
Oh, Samuel Jackson.
You know who I think it used to be?
Oh.
With Avengers, three Star Wars movies.
Yeah.
Jurassic Park.
Jeff Goldblum used to be the biggest movie star.
Yeah, yeah.
Because he was
Jurassic
in
Park.
Like Independence Day, and there's something else that came out, Jurassic Park.
Jurassic Park?
He was in like
first and second one,
the top three or four all-time grossing movies ever for a while.
Yeah.
And it was Jeff Goldblum.
Yeah.
But you wouldn't say
Jeff Goldblum.
Yeah, he doesn't just star in a movie. I mean, it's not since The Fly, right?
No, I get your point. No, yeah, he does.
In what?
The one with the vibes?
Yeah,
vibes.
Cyndi Lauper shout out. Nice.
Oh, I see.
All right, vibes was a while.
No, you put me in my place.
Into the night?
You're always stoked when you see Goldblum show up in a movie or when you see William Hurt show up in a movie. Like, they still have that resonance for those of us that grew
that's
up
a Paxton.
During
yeah.
that time.
What's
oh,
that
Paxton.
Called?
No,
a Terrence stamp approval.
A Terrence stamp approval. There you go.
We call it the Terrence stamp
you
approval.
You see them and you're like, okay, I'm in.
Yep.
And they're never disappoint. They never disappoint. So.
No. M. Emmett Walsh.
I
you see that guy? You're like, this, whatever's happening now is going to be good.
The guy from the Stern movie.
Giamatti.
Oh, Giamatti. Giamatti. Yes.
Well, this gets into my theory of people who are good in movies versus people who are in good movies.
Mm.
Oh, yeah.
Right?
Giamatti.
So Russell Crowe, he's good in movies. He's not always in good movies.
Right.
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 So
is there someone who's the opposite?
who's always in a good movie but not as, is not good in movies.
No. Kristen Stewart?
No.
Somebody's brother, I'm sure.
The guy that's always in the...
Frank Stallone.
Frank Stallone.
The friend of Adam Sandler.
Yeah, Rob Schneider is always in good movies.
Right?
He's not. Wait, you're saying Sandler movies are good movies?
Well, they're, some of them.
Is this a whole other genre?
Yeah, yeah.
This will be 3 hours.
I like
By the way, Adam
Drunk.
Sandler, no Mark Twain prize.
Yeah.
Oh.
I think that it's fairly rare when you...
Oh, forget it. Stop it, Kristen.
Stop it.
Kristen's going to tell us about important stuff.
But so on display are Jane Fonda's boobies in this. And I...
Yeah.
Yes.
Consider myself a bit of a connoisseur.
Yeah.
Much like spotting a toupee, I think sure. I can always dial in a fake rack.
Whoa.
And I can't tell what's going on with hers because there are a couple of scenes where clearly, like the mom, you're coming open that scene, mm-hmm. those are spectacular. Mm-hmm. But then there's other shots where she's pushed up and I could tell those aren't spectacular. So I wonder if they prosthetic gave her some prosthetics for one or two of those shots.
I think
I don't,
so.
I don't know yeah. if she's packing aftermarket or not.
I don't think she has fake boobs and are just making them look fake.
Yeah. Okay.
Yeah. Yeah. She didn't get fake. She's not.
No.
No, I thought she had them for
a
while.
She's not method.
She's not
method. I met her once and she seemed normal. Like things seemed normal.
Yeah. They might be pushed up, right? And then you put padding underneath to make it look
But when she's
I wish
out.
You could see the YouTube. Yeah. Go and watch Paul playing with his boobies. Fantastic. He's showing us with his hands how they're pushed up.
He's and here's a segue boobs. I'm going to force because
yes.
I've always wondered, speaking of fake boobs,
mm-hmm.
remember in The Office when Jan showed up like in a new season with a big fake rack? And Michael Scott was going to break up with her, but she showed up
with
a big fake rack.
That's right.
And he stayed with her. Did she get those in real life? And then they wrote that in? Because that's brilliant. I've always wondered that. And I haven't done enough Googling to figure out whether that actress actually went.
I can't believe you haven't looked into that and spent some time.
I'm a little disappointed in myself, too.
Yeah, I figure they start rolling credits and you're on the computer.
Where'd these come from? When do we get these?
They have a date right
am
up
I alone
under
in this
here.
Apparently.
No, yeah. We didn't notice
I never
that.
Followed that.
Yeah.
Did you remember that?
I do remember that.
That arc?
I remember not thinking that they weren't prosthetics.
Oh, okay. So you just assumed they were...
Yeah, I wouldn't imagine an actress would do that for real.
I'm always so taken with Jenna Fisher, I forget what else is going on.
Wow.
Pretty.
This reminds me, today I was doing something where I wanted to see whatever, some picture on Google, and I came across a picture of Barry Gibb and the Gibb brothers, and they were wearing the yellow outfits, and I have not... maybe I'm becoming more of a perv as I get older, but I could tell what religion people wore.
Hey-o.
Those pants were so tight.
Yeah.
I never thought about that. You know, when you're a kid, you're like, oh, the Barry Gibb. Holy shit, these men are running around in really tight spandex pants. The whole situation is wherever it is. As a man, do you love that people can see your cock?
No.
Or do you feel uncomfortable?
No.
No?
Wait, what are you
saying? I don't want anyone to see my cock.
But you know, like women kind of like when you could see a little bit of cleavage and some curve. But I don't know. Do men want you to see a little curve?
No,
and
girls don't
like it. Men focus on the biceps,
uh-huh.
and men focus, I think, maybe right on the abs. Those are the two things men focus on.
So like a tight
women
t-shirt.
Women gravitate to abs, and we think they gravitate to abs.
I'm starting to look at crotch more. I'm checking out crotch. I never used to. What are you going to do?
Well, fair enough.
Yeah, what?
Do you like moose knuckle? I mean,
no. When we work out with Glad, I'd stare at his crotch and I'm like, there's too much moose knuckle.
No, moose knuckle's no good.
Yeah.
Mm.
No, I think you should
see what you've done, Lee.
Yeah, I think you should earn figuring out what's going on down there.
You shouldn't be. They were telling me what was going on. Yeah.
Well, back then, that's the style. You're looking at the 70s, right?
Yeah.
Everyone was wearing
tights.
Right
up with ABBA.
They were all leading with their cock.
Right.
Yeah. And some of them, that explains the whole joke about, oh, he's got a sock in his pants.
Yeah.
You could see it.
Yeah.
Yeah.
That's why Tom Jones was legendary, because mm-hmm. we wore that stuff. You could see it.
I've always felt bad for women about that in dating, because when a guy dates a woman and he goes out on a date, he can pretty much assess the terrain underneath the clothes.
Right.
You know, you might be fooling me with a padded bra, and you might have something trussed up there, but for the most part, when things come off, I'm not going to be completely surprised. For women... Because we don't wear the Barry Gibb specials.
Yes. As you should be required.
It's Christmas morning every time, and you have no idea.
Yeah.
You might be getting a train set or socks.
Right.
Right?
Yeah.
And I've always thought that has to be the hardest thing for a woman to act enthused and thrilled.
Especially when you're disappointed.
When you're disappointed. And you don't know going in. You've had a great dinner. He's charming. He's polite. He lives in a nice house.
Right.
Ugh,
the worst is when you get you get that track with the car. And it breaks down
like
halfway
one
through.
Lap.
Oh,
that's really bad.
That's a great theory, Lee. See, now this is what you come up with.
This is what I like
when you're not looking up if Jan has fake Hooters.
You should find out.
I think that's good.
Thank you.
Yeah,
I like to bring a little something to the show.
Well, I think, and it goes into what she's doing now, right? Because she's embraced. She's got this new book and this new, I think it's a new videotape or DVD
Jane
series.
Fonda?
Yeah, Jane Fonda does. I'm sorry, Jane Fonda does. That she's pushing, embracing her sexuality at 70. That she's trying to encourage people at that age.
70?
Yeah.
She's like over there. I think
she's
over
still
there.
With Richard Perry? I don't
I
know if she's
so.
Still with him.
Because he was there at the AFI tribute they did for her a few weeks ago.
That's cool. Yeah, she seemed very happy with him.
Yeah. And so she's pushing this whole idea of embrace sexuality at your 70s and exploring, you know, having sex, how to reinvigorate that in your life if it's been dormant in your relationship, things of that nature. So it goes along with what she's doing. It's like perfect, what do you call it, synergy?
Cross-marketing.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, cross-marketing. Do that kind of character that's so free about talking about her sexuality at 70. And so it's a smart way to do it in the movie. There you go. Yeah, I'm just saying. Jane Fonda is a smart one. That's all I'm saying.
But now I want to see the movie where she's talking all about sex more than I want to see this one with all the other people.
This is where I bone you.
Yeah. All right, listen, we're going to take a 10-second break. Seriously, just 10 seconds. And then we'll be back here with our guest, Pat Finn. And then we'll have Pat on for the remainder of the show. And then at the end of the show, I'll say goodbye to everybody.
Oh. Nice.
Well, maybe not everybody.
Is that instrument that goes
it's like Soul Train Dance Line.
I love any song that has a bass line that's been played with somebody's thumb over the top.
Oh, yeah.
That's a heavy bass line.
You are definitely slapping the bass.
Because when they on the neck of the guitar, when they reach over with their thumb, that's a serious bass line.
Yeah, that's a.
Does anyone know who this artist is?
I'm gonna say that black guy with the dreads and the things on his hair. Who's that guy? The one with the beads?
It's like a Nile Rodgers and Cream.
Yeah.
Nile Rodgers?
One of those.
Rodgers and Cream?
Rodgers and Cream?
Rodgers and Cream.
No, that's our guest.
Who is it?
Not Stevie Wonder.
A little artist by the name of Pat Finn.
Wait,
oh.
Oh, is it really?
The craziest things happen when you hit YouTube.
No, that's funny. I've seen that picture.
Oh, yeah?
That's
got the afro.
Great. Wow. Great
that's
name.
Good.
And that is also our guest today, everybody, an improviser who performs with one of the best groups you'll ever see, Beer Shark Mice, featuring Neil Flynn, Dave Koechner, former Showcast guest Michael Coleman, and Pete Holney, and also an actor whose face has been regularly seen on shows like The Middle, Ed, Murphy Brown, as well as films like How High and It's Complicated, but to Seinfeld fans, you know him as Joe Mayo. Pat Finn is here.
Yay.
And he's going to do a number for us. So we're
I'm going to
he
the
pulls
lyrics
out,
to that song.
Oh, my God. He pulls out a little Cassie, and all of a sudden,
No, I think most of those noises were made with his hand.
Could be.
Right?
I'd love to, like, meet him and be like, ladies and gentlemen, Pat Finn with Pat Finn. Do some crazy lyrics. And
One Night Only.
Yeah.
So do you get a lot of Joe Mayo love?
I do, and it's great. It was for me, that show was like MASH or Cheers in that it was such an iconic show, and we just watched it every single Thursday. Yeah. And I remember I was at a birthday party of somebody's, like a kid's birthday party, and I got a call like, hey, you have an audition in the next half hour for Seinfeld. I was like, what? I left the party, went over to Radford, and it was like 20, 30 people there, and they said, great, everybody's going to audition, come back, and then we're going to just say, everybody can go except this person can stay, which is very cutthroat and very Hollywood and kind of creepy.
Yeah.
But it went well enough that I guess I was the guy. And so I went right over to the table read, which was insane.
It's crazy.
They're all there. And the table read is usually a half hour or 40 minutes or so for a sitcom. In this case, it was over an hour. Because people had to leave the table because they were laughing so hard. People had to, like, couldn't control. It was insane. I'm like, this is the coolest. Like, the elephant doors were bowing with laughter. It was just so, like, wow, this is honestly the funniest place. If you had a little pinpoint Google thing, the funniest place on Earth right now. So, but it was great. And the cast was incredible. And
well, that's an episode that, you know, you can pick the Junior Mint episode. Or you can pick
Superman.
But this episode had, like, five awesome storylines that are classic. George's Fat Wallet, right?
Yeah. Wouldn't that great? Which could have been a whole show.
Yeah, could have been a whole show. Yeah. Same with the man bag.
Yes.
Yeah.
Or
purse.
Or merch.
Man purse.
And the coat.
Yep.
You know? And the the reverse. It's called People. Reverse People. It is the name of the episodes. Yeah, so there's like tons of stuff going on in that
episode.
It was crazy,
and it was nice because
and that was like the last season.
It was.
So they're still cranking out great episodes.
It was the final season, and the kindest thing was that halfway through, Jerry had asked if I'd come back as a recurring character, which was like you can't get more fire than that.
Yeah.
And so I was like, great, I would be honored to. And then like a few weeks later, he called my manager to say they can't bring me back, and they apologize because they've just announced it's the last season. So
now, did he call?
Jerry did, or Jerry's people. But I mean, I wouldn't be surprised.
Well, there's
if
a slight
did.
Difference.
That's
no,
amazing
but he was
that, he reached
that
out.
Nice.
Yeah,
it
yeah.
was really impressive because I'm like, I'm going to do my job and just kind of you know, keep my tail between my legs and
stay in your lane.
Yeah, exactly. And these guys were like, so where are you from, Pat? What's going on? I'm like, oh my God. But it was me and the four of them and Wayne and. They one day I came in and Julia, who was amazing,
and
came up,
Wayne,
you know,
I know, came up and she jumps up and hugs me, and she goes, "They added a scene," and I'm like, "You're kidding." She goes, "They never add scenes, and we're long anyways." I was like, "You're kidding." So for those that don't know, in this scene, they wrote the scene that I had to meet Elaine at the diner because she was in charge of coats and she was missing my coat, so I was like, "Hey." Look, Elaine. Was the guy to talk to her about the film. So I came in. She was waiting for me at the booth. I came in, and she's like, "Oh, hi, thanks for coming." I was like, "You got it." And by the way, Joe Mayo was a sound guy.
That's where the name came from.
And it was always a weird thing because it was always like, "Who was there? Mike, Sally, Bill, Joe Mayo, Andy was there." It's like they always said his whole name. Like one of those guys. And that was another side.
Paul Preston.
Yeah, Paul Preston.
Paul Preston.
Guns N' Roses. So, the scene that they wrote was I sat down with Julia Elaine and I said, Elaine, thanks for meeting me here. And could you hold on a second? And I turned to this guy eating like soup by himself. And I said, sorry, sir, do you know what time it is? And he said, yeah, it's about 2 minutes to four. Great. Do me a favor. Tell me when it's 4 o'clock. Thanks so much. Elaine, we got a problem with the coat. And we had our scene and this guy like sheepishly turned after like 2 minutes and went, excuse me. And I'm like, yeah. He goes, you said to tell you when it's 2 minutes? I was like, right, thanks. Elaine, I got to go. It was like my whole world was just run by everybody but me. So it was so cool. But we never even got to shoot it because they were so long. But it was really flattering that they thought well enough of the character.
So
but
funny.
It was really neat to do. It was really
I have an actor question for you because I think this is brilliant. So you end up, you run over there, you get to the table read. How, as an actor, do you handle that? Do you go full on during the read, or do you hang back? Do you gauge it by everybody else? What do you
do? That's a great question. It's, I mean, I've been sometimes like with Will Ferrell when Will sells it, man.
Name
I mean,
drop.
No, go ahead. Sting always said not to do that.
I win. I win. I said under 3 minutes. I said.
Oh my gosh. Affleck's picking me up.
He's out of here.
Yeah. So,
oh, you mean the duck?
Yes.
Yeah. Yeah.
So he does. So you do kind of gauge it with what's everyone doing because you don't want to be kind of the guy like, oh, look at Broadway Joe over here. Yeah. You know, I need the police. You know? So you do, but you do kind of want to sell it, and some people get eye contact, you know, which is great, and you do kind of want to give it a performance, but you are handcuffed a little bit because you're sitting and you're with a script and it's words that could easily change or you just gotten so.
And you just got them in that case.
So yeah, very much so.
You
went
to the audition and then straight to the table read?
Yeah, it was really weird. I went back to the birthday party. My wife was like, God, it took forever. And I was like, yeah, I just got Seinfeld.
Whoa.
What? It was just
and like, I just did the table read.
Right, exactly.
I love that the birthday party continued throughout this whole time.
Right, yes,
exactly. World so people are in the bouncy house. He comes back. His daughter's still in the bouncy house. What?
There's like 11 tails on the donkey. Passed out.
But that's a great thing because you're not just in a Seinfeld episode. You're Joe May. You're called out. People know that.
Yeah, it is. It's always interesting when, you know, I'll be in an airport or at the store or something like that with my kids or whatever, and you have a hat on and you're not shaving and you're just, you know, you're picking up, you know, a rake or something. And it's just like, you know.
Which people do.
I literally was at Home Depot and I'm kind of looking for, what were we looking for? Something. My son and I. Oh, we were building up a hand plane for a GoPro. But
cool.
As we're walking, it is really cool, but we're walking through and these two guys just walk by and they go, dude, that was just Joe Mayo. And then you're kind of like, where are the... where's the mahogany wood? Of course, I'm high-end.
Yeah, it's like Joe DiVola and somebody... I mean,
who was the rival stand-up?
I had a woman...
Kenny Banya.
Kenny Banya.
Oh, yeah,
that's
Banya.
Right.
Yeah.
Ovaltine. That's gold, Jerry. Gold.
Yeah. No, that's a badge of honor. I mean...
Banya, right.
The first thing you did was the George Wendt Show.
I did, yeah. I was actually pulled off a second city stage. My goal from Marquette was to take classes at the Improv Olympic and Second City, and my goal was to someday meet somebody on the main stage. And then I actually got the main stage the same week I got the George Wendt Show. So it was like, and then I was kind of like, God, I should probably change my goals a little bit.
You're aiming a little low.
Someday I want to find a button.
I hope to meet a guy that met somebody.
Right, exactly.
Meet the man that met Ollie.
Yeah. But yeah, so I ironically enough, at Second City, I was doing a show that Bernadette Burkett was the director of, and she is amazing and was at Second City and is married to George Wendt.
Oh, cool.
So
oh,
wow. George and Peter Tolan, who's done a lot of TV and film analyze this and that, and a great guy, they flew out to, like, scout me, which I didn't know about. And halfway through.
That's better, isn't it, when you don't know?
Yeah, it was on your own turf, yep. Which was kind of cool. I didn't have to come out.
So were you, where were you? On main stage?
I was in Second City. No, I was at Second City Northwest at the time.
So did you look up. That was still when they had Northwest. Yeah. Wow.
Did you look off into the wings and there's, like, two guys in bike shorts and ball caps with clipboards scouting you?
They were,
that would be great. Like,
what's with the stopwatch?
Were you in the Madness of Curious George?
No.
No,
we saw that.
I was the one I saw out there. CD-ROM wasn't built in a day, and I forget the other one. I was in two reviews, and then I got the main stage to replace Jackie Hoffman.
Oh, okay.
And you really could play Jackie Hoffman's
parts.
Thank
you. Finally,
I understand.
That was an acknowledgement, and I needed that. So I got that, and then I flew out to L.A. probably 10 times, because CBS was like, well, you're out of your mind. We're putting some guy we've never even heard of on TV, much less a show that's going on in the air. And
this was the Cheers follow-up, right?
It was, yeah. So, and George and I became good friends. And the greatest thing about it was that I got to be friends with Peter Tolan and meet a bunch of great writers. Brian Doyle Murray, who's on it. We're from the same parish back in
Chicago.
Friend
of the show?
Love Brian.
Yeah, sure. He's so great.
Kind of.
But he, great guy.
Nice.
Super sweet.
Everybody has to impersonate that.
George Wendt is one of my dearest friends. And he and Bernadette are the godparents to my youngest.
Wow.
That is cool.
Isn't that neat?
Yeah. That's
Cheers
Chicago.
To you. See what I did there?
You know what's great is he signs his autograph, Cheers. He goes, it's so easy. No.
It is kind of perfect.
Is, yeah,
why
like,
not,
oh,
right?
Brilliant. I don't really have a, you know.
I saw him in art in London.
He's really good.
He was
art.
So good.
Yeah. Oh, yeah.
Stacey really Keach, him and David Dukes, I think his name was, and it was fantastic. We were there in 98.
George Wendt?
George Wendt.
Yeah. Doing something other than comedy?
Yeah. He was also a Hairspray.
Oh, wow. Yes.
Oh, my God. Did he play the mother?
Yes.
Fantastic. Yes.
He did a movie that won a lot of awards. I forget the name of it. I think it was like him and Joe Mantegna, and they went to like a cabin. And then he told all his friends that he was gay. George did. And then some didn't like it. Some were confused. But it wasn't Lifeboat. But you should look it up. It did really. It was a great movie.
Wow. This is the second time we've had a guest that was in a movie where they all go to a cabin. It almost seems like those one location cabin movies are sort of real popular.
They fix his budget in the amusement park.
Well, cabin.
Cabin. Yeah,
disorganized crime.
No, but speaking of short fat guys from funny shows, I ran into Jason Alexander outside.
Sure.
Now, I honestly believe he may be one of the greatest actors ever.
He's good.
Because when you meet Jason Alexander, the furthest thing from your mind is George Costanza.
Oh, yeah.
He is so not that guy.
No, he's such a sweet, nice guy.
Right?
And he is a good actor. You're right. I was.
So I'm wondering if that's the same for George. I mean, for George Wendt.
I would say, and he likes doing it too. I mean, I've never really had the desire to play like a murderer or different things. Like, I mean, I've done auditions where it's like, you know, I'm in a foxhole in Germany and they're like, great, do it again, but. Don't smile so much.
Exactly.
You know, it's like because half of the dead person is in your arms when you're saying it. And you're, you know, and don't come up on the end of the lines. We got to get the Germans? It's World War II. You won. So, you know that. Go with that.
I was in audition with, I had to play the bitchy mom. And I mean, obviously I'm a pain in the ass, but I just was not selling bitchy or something. And the guy was so frustrated because I think he really wanted to use me. He's like, no, just be bitchy. And I'm like, no.
Oh, I just lived like Paul around the house for the next month. How did you not get that?
Exactly.
Right there. Why did you just say that? I should film
that.
Where
are the cameras?
You just did it.
Exactly.
You just
did it. Filming.
I should break another dish. Hear what you have to say about it.
Pretend I didn't wash the dishes. That's it. That's your motivation.
Exactly. Look at this shirt I'm wearing.
That's your motivation.
I'm drinking.
So we met you when you were on tour with Second City.
Yeah.
You may or may not remember. We were in Buffalo.
In SUNY?
At the SUNY Buffalo.
Yeah. We met you there. We asked all sorts of more advanced questions than the other people. Other people are like, how do you make up things?
Yeah.
And Paul and I are like, are you equity? And nice. Are you getting paid for the regular rate as a main stage performer? And Brian Stack is like, you guys, if you want, after the show, yeah. I can talk to you personally. We're like, oh, okay.
So we dinnered thereafter.
And he's
yeah,
been
Renee Albert, Spanish
yeah,
Wick.
Yeah.
Susie Nakamura.
Right?
Great cast.
Great
yeah,
cast. Great strong cast. Cast.
We went on afterwards, right?
Yeah.
Shoot,
yeah.
I'm trying to. Where was yeah. it?
Buffalo.
No, but where in Buffalo? Oh, Wings. Oh. We went to Wings.
Probably
place.
A Wings place.
I mean, no, when it went to the Anchor or whatever it is.
Yeah,
Anchor
when
Bar?
In doubt.
Yeah. Yeah. Wow. Okay.
You guys couldn't have been nicer. It was very cool. And when we moved to Chicago, we called Brian and said, oh, we're here. What should we do? And he was cool because we couldn't get right into the Second City classes we wanted to get into. So he's like, well, go over to Improv Olympic. I know you haven't heard of it, and it's just starting yeah. up. But you're going to love it. And Tina Fey was over there, Amy wow. Poehler, everybody. Wow. And he was right, and it was great.
I mean, I was told the same advice. I came down yeah. from Marquette, and I'm like, I don't know what to do.
Yeah.
And then somebody was like, Joel Murray was like, Improv Olympic in Second City.
Yeah.
And I was like, oh, okay, cool. And then both were like, oh, I'm.
Yeah, I've yet to experience as good a teachers as I did back there.
Yeah,
great ones.
I mean,
Toronto had great teachers.
Toronto had great teachers. Yeah, Bruce Hunter, mm-hmm. Deborah Kimmett, good teachers. Alan Gutman.
Mm-hmm.
Wow, you guys have I dropped around. Enough names?
You guys have been around.
Well, wow. It's no Will Ferrell
been taught
or
something. Right? Yeah.
He's been taught a lot.
Wait, who else taught me? Tom
yeah,
Cruise.
Tom Cruise, right?
What?
Sandra Bullock.
Hugh Downs. I don't want to drop a name, but Roger Mudd.
There was that. There was that summer in Prague.
Yeah.
Indie great comedy? Tom Sneva.
Did you ever end up in Amsterdam? We never ended up in Amsterdam with comedy.
No.
Did you?
No. No, I've been to Ireland.
Oh, okay.
We did Kilkenny at the Cat Laughs. Comedy festival, which was amazing. Nice. It was really cool because there were stand-ups there, and they also had kind of like sketch comedy, and it was like a little Woodstock kind of area in the town called Kilkenny. And then we came in and we just did pure improv, and they literally were camping out in tents on the river.
Wow.
To come see it. They were so like blown away.
Well, back then it was so new.
It is, yeah.
Yeah, it was really unique.
We'd done it enough that we were okay at it. We had some good people there with us.
Is that right? They sound Amish, but they really hadn't seen this before.
Well, I mean, that would be early 90s back when we were doing it. It was relatively new.
15 years ago, something like that. Yeah, so it was kind of new. But they just didn't have it in a small town in Ireland. So yeah, it was a big hit there, which was kind of cool.
Let me ask you what we ask every guest on the show.
Yeah.
What is your favorite movie of all time?
Wow. And I'm sure everyone says, that's a tough one.
Well, it is.
It's always weird if somebody goes, you know, Bullet or somebody. I didn't think I've seen
I have your answer. I have an answer. Over time.
Well, the reason it's tough, Pat, is because there is a wrong answer. So.
Oh, Lord.
Be careful. Right.
Lots of pressure.
Anything I'm in? No.
I agree.
You know what? I always.
How High is your favorite movie of all time?
It is. It's better than the book.
Really? Better than Soul Plane?
It is. I always loved On the Waterfront. Oddly enough, as a movie, I just thought it was a really cool movie.
Yeah.
But just my life has always been, I've always kind of gravitated towards comedy and obviously The Stripes and the Caddyshack. I caddied at the place where Caddyshack was written.
Nice.
So I know the names of the people are actually their names. And
that's something.
So it's pretty wild to like watch that and see things like I was a caddy at Caddy Day and it was...
That's
hilarious.
That's northern Chicago.
It is. It was a place called Indian Hill.
Okay.
And it was white Anglo-Saxon Protestant. That's why I christened thee the Flying Wasp. And Catholics were frowned upon. They could caddy.
Wow.
Yeah.
Hey, you probably knew that, though. You read Bill Murray's book, right?
Well, I don't remember everything, but yes.
Yeah. Well, Bill grew up, the Murrays grew up, my mom and Mrs. Murray, they went to church every day together.
Well, that's what you were saying about Joel, that you guys knew each other from.
So Joel, we went all to the same grammar school and then to high school together. So
that's cool.
Out here, it's really cool, yeah. And so we've become insanely great friends and our families have, we've just vacationed together and stuff like that. So it is kind of cool to.
Do you know his sister?
I know all of his sisters. Yeah.
Oh,
I know his sister.
The nun?
The singing performing nun?
Because when Joel was here, we were talking about his sister. I said, we have your lovely sister, the nun. He's like, she's crazy. We're like, she does a show.
My favorite ever is I'm talking to Brian one day, and he goes, how you doing? He goes, good. I saw, went down to Florida. Went down to Florida. Joel does a better one.
Joel does an amazing one.
He did it here and it killed.
Yeah, it's insane.
It killed.
So I'm like the minor league team.
But let's see what you have.
Yeah, I want to see what you have to offer. We'll be over here timing.
So he goes. I went down to Florida to go see her in a one woman play. Uh-huh. And I go, great, what was it? He goes, she was Joan of Arc.
Yes.
And I go, that's right. Amazing.
And she's so much older.
Yeah, and I go, how was it? And Brian goes, she overacted. What? He was overacting, I told her. I go, it's Joan of Arc. She was like 12, burned at the stake. How do you have a teenager that's too... And he goes, I was honest.
Oh, my God, it's so good.
Younger than a nun portraying a saint. Kids, oh there's no...
That's so. Amazing. Thank
Wait,
you.
Wait, the guest is
That's
hedging. Amazing. So what's your favorite movie? Is it
oh,
on the Waterfront?
Oh, so then the guest is hedging. I love it.
Wait, can I give him more time real quick?
And I'll tell you, a movie I loved... And this summer had an amazing experience. I always liked It's a Wonderful Life, and subsequently I liked Field of Dreams. And I love sports movies. Huge, you know, Heaven Can Wait, all that kind of stuff, Rudy. And Field of Dreams is one of my favorites. And this summer I was lucky enough to play in a charity event with Kevin and and Bob Costas and people at the Field of Dreams. So and to meet him and to be in the house, and it's exactly the same.
The house is the same?
I'm in the house. I go, I'm in the house. They shot everything in the house. It's in the house. I didn't go to New York or LA to do it. And so I'm at home plate, like hitting a ball. I got like a base hit and I'm like running in the corn. You know, it just was so
awesome.
Yeah. So I think that really became.
And that's how you name drop. Do it.
Yeah, you're right.
You have a whole story in which Kevin Costner and Bob Costner.
Well, I had lunch with Cary Goldenberg.
What I love about On the Waterfront is that the line, I could have been somebody, I could have been a contender instead of a bum, is such a throwaway line in that. And it's glossed over really quickly. And I've never heard that line in, you know, from the movie. I didn't hear it before I heard people quoting it. And so when I saw On the Waterfront, I was expecting this very heavy gravitas moment. And no, they're just in the back of the cab, and he just kind of slides it past everybody.
Yeah, it's a cool little, like,
I love that
scene with, like, in the cab has, like, the drapes on it.
I love any car with drapes in it.
Yeah. The other thing, and I had heard this, I assume it's true, it makes sense to me, but in the ending scene when Brando is walking, like, he got beat up on the wharf, and he finally, if he walks back in to work, then it's over and you win. So he had to, you know, physically walk, and he was in so much pain. And back in those days, they used chocolate to look like blood.
Oh, yeah.
Because you couldn't see. Mm-hmm. And Brando's, the thing he loathed the most was the smell of chocolate. And so he goes, I'll give you one take. So it's one take, and he said, every time I wanted to be like, wince or have a horrible, like, picture what you hate to smell, and he would just go... And he would just have this amazing hatred in his face.
Wow.
And went in. I'm like, I hope it's true.
If I did that, I would look orgasmic because I love chocolate. I'd be like, yes.
Why is she disrobing? What's going on? Now we're NC-17 out of nowhere. The car with the drapes.
Her nipples are hot. What?
Hey, what is that?
Car with the drapes.
Quite a statement the filmmaker's making.
Yeah, exactly. The editor, wow, that's different. I didn't see that in the script.
Well, we only got one take.
No, exactly. Like, ruin one take.
Yeah, put that in.
What's going on? You gotta use it.
Can I ask a Murray family question?
Yeah.
Who was the brother that did Moving Violations?
Johnny.
Love that movie.
Yeah.
People don't talk about it enough.
Yeah, that's good.
And I thought he was going to rival what Bill did. Because I remember seeing that in the theater in a small town in Virginia. And I was like, this is great.
I think they expected that kind of stuff. I don't know what happened there. I don't know.
Nobody gives love to it. They love Summer School, but they don't love
Moving Violations. We've talked about it here because it's the brother's movie. Because it also has James Keach.
Right, James Keach is one of the teachers.
Yeah.
That's right.
Yeah.
I love that.
That's funny.
But no, that was, and then it had Clara Peller.
Yes.
Where's the beef lady?
Why is my back getting wet?
She's going to be huge, and then she was done. Yeah.
She sits in the urinal. Why is my back getting wet?
That's right.
She thinks she's going to the bathroom.
Right.
All right.
Nice. But you talk about sports for a second. Right. You're wearing the Bears hat.
I am.
Are you a huge Bears fan?
Yeah, I like the Bears. I grew up in Chicago, and as a kid, always loved the Bears and the Blackhawks. And it's funny, whether it's good or bad, we moved out here, so we have three kids, and my wife is from Springfield downstate, and which, by the way, is where you went in sports in high school. Like, when you were in high school, it was like your goal.
Oh, for like Allstate?
Like, when you were like, okay, here's the first game of our conference, you wanted to win the conference, so subsequently you would go downstate.
Right.
Oh, okay.
So you would always chant, everybody in, where are we going? And then everyone would yell downstate. So I had, like, the first time I'm coaching my daughter, like, six-year-old AYSO soccer. I was like, everybody in here, let's go. All right. I'm going to say, where are we going? You guys scream downstate. They're like, where are we going? Downstate. And they're all kind of like dispersing. And it's like, we're going to like San Diego? Carlsbad? La Jolla? I'm confused. And I'm
like,
going,
why are we going to Tijuana?
Yeah, right.
Why is
then I'm
happening?
Like, where do they go here? And they go, Sacramento. I'm like, oh, upstate doesn't have the same ring.
The same.
Sac town? No. But yeah, so I grew up liking all the.
You been on the Bear Down podcast?
I have not, you know, with Walshy. They're good friends of mine.
Nunez was on here. And
was he?
He's
great.
That podcast. That's a good podcast.
I should probably jump over on that one.
You're such a homer. I mean, you would just
know
everything they talk about.
Yeah, yeah. No, I golfed with Jim McMahon this summer.
Oh,
so it was kind of a crazy.
Golfing with Jim McMahon.
Yeah, isn't that
nuts? Baseball with the.
He's really good.
Wait, the Punky QB or the WWE guy?
No, the Punky QB.
Okay.
But he's really good.
We're the same golf name, right?
That's true.
When are you going to go diving with Richard Dreyfuss?
Vince McMahon.
We're going to do those random.
Thank you.
You know.
Somebody needs to correct that.
Yeah.
Is there a great football movie? It's funny you mentioned two.
I Heaven Can Wait. The original, I think, is great.
Yeah.
Rudy, I love.
Because so many great baseball movies.
There are. Yeah. But Friday Night Lights.
Yeah.
Is that good?
No, that is good. But then the other one I'm thinking of is
The Game Stands Tall. Probably is what you're thinking.
You're probably.
No, We Are Marshall is good.
We Are Marshall.
We Are Marshall is good. Surprisingly,
he's good in it, McConaughey.
Clash of the Titans, I love that one.
That's, I think, one of my favorites.
You remember the Titans?
No, Remember the Titans.
Remember the Clash of the Titans?
Remember the night they played the Titans.
What's the one with the blonde woman? That's good.
Oh,
Wildcats.
Wildcats.
Yes.
Oh.
Yeah.
Goldie Hawn. The blonde woman.
You ugly.
I couldn't think of it.
The blondie woman.
You why? You ain't got no alibi. You ugly. You ugly.
I had that on beta. I'm that old.
Wow.
I had that on beta.
I think it was shot in Chicago.
Yeah. That's Woody Harrelson. Wesley
Snipes. Is he in that?
Yes.
Wow.
And
Forrest Whitaker. Young actors.
James Keach.
James Keach.
Around.
It's true.
Boom.
Bringing that shit around.
And Swoozy, of course.
It's frightening that you know that so quickly.
And Swoozy Kurtz.
Well, let's play a little round of...
What did you see this week?
I never actually say the K.
No, you don't.
Oh, yeah.
Well, it's because you're rocking out hard.
But it's
you don't
weak.
Pop it,
what did you see this week? I put it to the table. What did you get out?
Was that Pat Finn, by the way?
No, that was...
I just thought maybe his second album was kicking in. And
FYNN.
He went
What did you see this week?
Paul, I saw True Crime, which is TV.
True Detective.
So, True Detective, sorry.
True Crime.
I saw True Detective.
True Crime is a movie.
A movie. Very good. I'll just put that out there because it's not a TV show, but...
True Crime?
I saw True Detective.
Oh, True Detective.
Yeah. Oh,
it's a show or a movie?
It's a show on HBO, right?
That's the Woody and...
And Matthew McConaughey. Yeah. So good.
It's a 9-hour fantastic movie.
Amazing. It's like a really long movie.
Is it 9 episodes?
Okay. Yeah. So you can sit there and binge properly.
Are they doing more?
With different actors,
apparently,
I believe.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm.
They
really
want to keep
their brothers.
The casting prestige, so they're looking at Brad Pitt or Jake Gyllenhaal to be in it, something like that.
They're actually looking at women.
Nice. Oh, yeah.
Jessica Biel is apparently announced this morning that she's in the running.
Nice.
And they're looking at her, but they're also looking at Elizabeth Moss and a couple other ladies.
Wow,
too.
That'd be cool.
And, the girl from Thor. Alexander. Jamie Alexander. They're looking at her. Sif, the girl who plays Sif. So.
Just keep the production team intact, because that show was written every episode by the same guy.
Oh,
every
wow.
episode directed by the same guy.
Right.
And so it had this remarkable consistency, and so I just hope they do that again.
Yeah.
It makes you wonder how a show like Boardwalk Empire or something that just runs through all these different directors and stuff manages that same tone.
Yeah,
but it's all of the showrunner, I imagine. But this is especially just
it's cool.
There's
constant
quality,
from beginning to end, quality.
There's quality makeup too, because you see movies like Monuments Men, or you'll see
J. Edgar, beautiful line.
And the makeup is irritating because you can tell that they're doing old age makeup.
Right.
But when you first start watching this movie, you're not sure where you are, except by the makeup, and it's so good. They make them look so great young and so great. Normal age. I don't know. It's crazy.
It did only have to jump 15 years, though, which also they could do.
Yeah, but those guys had to get younger. It's hard to make people younger than what they are.
Yeah.
They weren't going back to their age and getting older.
They were talking about pushing 40 in one scene.
Right?
Yeah. So, but no, they were both fantastic.
You could tell Woody had his younger hair on. So he had a lot of blonde, younger hair.
I'm a big fan bringing Pat up. Well, I again, not to bore the regulars of our audience, but I'm a big proponent of bringing into acceptance the fact that a man of my follicle nature should be able to just put on hair for the occasion. right? So evening hair,
right.
Because it goes well with the suit.
Oh, cool.
And I'm not trying to fool anybody. Yeah. I don't want you to think I think you're fooled. Right. I just want you to know, hey, I have some hair for the tuxedo that I'm wearing.
Right.
Yeah.
I like
so.
The look.
Yeah.
Like girls do that. We'll wear extensions if we're getting all sexed
and
out.
An updo or downdo, long. Yeah, I think it should be acceptable. I should have
ponytail.
My Travolta hair. My, you know, right?
He doesn't give a shit.
He has award show hair. He has Oprah hair. He does.
I want award show hair.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, so. My Adele Dazeem hair. But that Woody is no joke, and I've been a fan of his since Cheers. Again, my favorite show.
Yeah, he's great.
My favorite sitcom ever.
He's
and just
very good.
Yeah, it's unbelievable. And you know, he's got a couple Oscar nominations. You might forget if you're watching. And be great in Zombieland that he's so brilliant in Larry Flint and The Messenger.
He's
just great.
Flint.
Oh, Larry Flint, he
was he nominated?
He was nominated, and it was originally offered to Bill Murray.
Wow.
There you go.
Whatever happened to him?
I know. Schmuck, right?
Yeah.
What else did anybody see?
I saw The Drop this afternoon, actually.
Not I am jealous of that.
Yeah.
K-A-S-L, The Drop.
We didn't cover it here because it's going to get a limited release.
Oh, right.
But, so I'm glad you saw it so we can at least tell folks
we live in
what
LA,
it is.
So we get the limited.
Yeah, we see everything. Nice. Everything we want to.
Yeah, saw it over at The Grove. Tom Hardy. Yeah, Noomi Rapace. I think that's how you say her name.
Tom Hardy.
I think so. That's how Americans say it.
Right. And, of course, the late, great James Gandolfini. It's his last movie that he did. It's fantastic. It's so good. Dennis Lehane, who was a fantastic author, actually did the screenplay as well.
And it's
really interesting, and it all hinges on this dog. The whole thing hinges on the dog.
I love it already.
Beautiful,
tell us.
Beautiful, heartbreakingly beautiful little baby pit bull. And it is the cutest. It's everything not to try to reach for it through the screen. He's so beautiful. But it carries... That start is the inciting action for the whole movie.
Let me guess. He swallows the key to the safe where the fortune is.
That's right.
And then he escapes, and we have to go find him.
To wait for him to poop. Yeah.
That's right. It's 20 minutes.
I need to add this to my. I'm going to add that to my list because I forget. Things to watch.
What was it called? Get That Rascal. Oh, The Drop. The Drop.
The Drop. Yes.
Lehane is great. Lehane wrote. For those who don't know, Dennis Lehane wrote the novels, or at least the scripts for Gone Baby Gone, which is a great underrated.
He wrote the novels,
And Mr. Griver.
That's right.
Wow.
That's right. And this is based on a short story called Animal Rescue, which is a beautiful
I never
title.
Would have got that from the trailer. Man, that is left out of the trailer. It's just like Gandolfini and Tom Hardy being badass.
You think it's going to be them against these Chechens, and then you watch the movie and not that at all.
Dare
but
I
it's still
say,
badass.
Dare I say it wasn't the movie you thought it was going to be?
Yeah.
Lee's favorite thing.
I love a good short. That's so cool that somebody just wrote a short. Hey, that's 8 minutes. Well, Napoleon Dynamite was a short.
Was it?
Right.
Yeah.
Wow. So was Sling Blade. That was a short that Billy Bob wrote. Yeah. Billy Bob shot, and then they turned it into
Fatal Attraction was a short, and the credit on the poster is whoever I can't remember who wrote it, but it said screenplay by blah 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 based on his screenplay. It's one of the weirdest credits that's ever been, but it's what it says on the poster.
Yeah. Yeah, I gave up all hope of being able to understand what would make a good movie or not after I saw Fight Club, and then I read the book Fight Club.
Oh yeah,
and I thought, how the hell did anyone read this and go, oh, this is what it should look like?
Yeah,
but what's that?
Yeah, I know that somebody said that the movie The Matrix had when you would read the script, it had like 10 pages of how to read the script. Like it was like, this is how.
Oh, wow.
You, I would never make it through.
How do you even pitch that?
Right? Yeah.
You're just like, all right, here, smoke this for an hour.
Take the blue weed, the red weed.
Take these pills. I'm gonna go get this validated. I'll be right back.
The opposite is a Jackie Chan movie where you're reading the script and story, and then there'll be a page with nothing on it except in the middle it says Jackie Chan fight scene. Then you flip it and more dialogue and say, and they just get that part just gets taken
like
care of. Don't worry about
just
it.
Somebody doing this.
Yeah, we got that covered.
Got
focus
it.
On the words.
In 8-bit.
Yeah.
No, the adaptation was like that, right? Because it was White Orchid.
Yeah.
And then you're like, how did they turn this into a movie? And it's all about trying to turn it into a movie. It's the movie within the movie,
which
is so
done
funny.
Very well with adaptation, but sometimes can feel like a cheat.
Yeah,
like,
sure.
I'm going to make the movie about making the movie,
right.
Which.
I need to see the movie again because I saw adaptation and I went, I don't get it. I just,
oh, really?
And then someone explained it to him and I went, that's brilliant. I need to see it again. So I need to see it again.
Yeah.
So.
I want to see Drop, too. That sounds good.
Oh, it's so good.
Yeah.
It's so good. It's showing all around town.
And by the way, I love the visual of the dog and waiting for the key. And you know there's an old lady like staring at it.
That's the Drop.
That's the poster. Yeah. Right.
And Gandolfini's like, what? Get out of here. You never see anybody do this?
That's awesome.
We hosted a screening of Willy Wonka and the Chocolate Factory.
Wow.
Nice.
Karen and I did as the movie guys over at our credit union.
Our credit union is
Burbank.
Pretty kick-ass.
It's like the greatest credit. First of all, credit union, over a bank. Just go out and make that happen. Take your money, put it in a credit union.
All of a sudden, the Yumi Credit Union is a sponsor of tonight's show.
I'll take that. But they said, hey, we're going to start projecting movies on the side of our bank wall, show up in the parking lot, and all the vendors will come out and give you, like, dollar popcorn and stuff.
Yeah.
And, we did a bunch of trivia giveaways, and we, you know, kept the party light, and it was fun. Yeah, and that's a great film.
Yeah.
I like it much better than the remake, although they say... Willy Wonka and the Chocolate Factory.
I lost focus, sorry. Sorry, yes.
Yeah. I heard popcorn and I went...
By the way, that also sounds like that would be a good, like, movie, like a heist movie. So what we're going to do is we're going to show these things at the bank.
Right? Oh, right! You're right!
So, well, like $1 popcorn for the kids.
Pending.
Oh, shoot, did I lose it?
I called it.
Sadly, the fire department and the police department both
They
present.
Were both there, or, but they're busy.
Or that's the challenge.
Or yeah. Yeah, right, exactly. Yes.
I smell quick change.
I'm watching a preview of Drop 2 and like, wait a second. More dropping.
But if you're listening in the Burbank area, we'll be back for a screening of Ghostbusters.
On October 10th.
October 10th.
Nice.
Yeah. So, I mean, that should be huge.
I am wearing the Ghostbusters. I am always wearing the Ghostbusters shirt.
I know.
Yay!
Which Ghostbusters shirt are you wearing is the question every day.
Did you go see the reissue in the theater?
We did.
Yes, of course.
Oh, we went on about that.
Happy with the print? I heard people weren't happy with the print.
I was fine with it.
Fine with it, yeah.
Yeah, I mean, they did a 4K thing. Anytime they do 4K on an old... movies, you can't tell too much. Yeah, and it should be a little ugly.
I agree.
Yeah,
I don't know why people complain. I love that.
Nah, that was no
complaints. We were kids when we watched this. What we enjoyed about it, right? Mm-hmm. That's what I think.
Yeah, I agree.
Always a big hair hanging in one of the corners.
Check the gate. What? I heard it in Europe. Let's go.
No, but we talked about how that movie, that movie is kind of timeless in that the costumes aren't stuck in the 80s.
Yeah.
You know, New York kind of doesn't look like it's caught in some kind of time warp. They don't go to places that have horribly changed. Library looks like a library. Firehouse looks like a firehouse.
Nobody pulls out a giant phone with a huge antenna to call for the Ghostbusters. Right. You know?
Before that. When they do a stop-action dog, you know, attacking Rick Moranis, that's where it's suddenly you're in the 80s. And you get, but you deal with it, and you kind of go, nah. You watch the church kind of move a little bit when the Stay Puft is going to step on it. But it's just because that's what it was. You kind of don't want to see that cleaned up.
Yeah, I agree. I'm with you on that.
Yeah, so that was a great, great print, and sadly only a week in theaters.
Did you see anything, Pat?
I did not. I was actually out of town for a little bit. We see movies a ton at the house with the kids a lot, which I love.
The in-home screening room?
Yeah, it's just regular television.
Called TV.
Oh, okay.
Exactly. No, we make popcorn and watch a ton of movies.
That's
and,
great.
I love it.
It's
really
good the
do.
Family. Like it that, is. It's so important to have that
and
family.
It's, right? There's so many, you know, when the kids are little, or it's funny, you get some of these parents that are like, oh, we're going to watch, you know, some, you know, like Animal House. You're like, kid's 10. You know, so, and there's plenty of movies that aren't. And you can also get movies, like we got Blues Brothers, but we got it on GN, so they take out all the cussing and all that kind of stuff, so it's kind of cool. And the girls love the music. Mm-hmm. Right. So there's a ton of movies that we watch. And so,
well, it's a good era for like having to, if you feel like you're stuck with your kid watching an animated movie, at least a good era where there's a ton of great animated
movies. There are,
movies.
Yeah.
Like really back great. In the like early 90s, you had only Disney.
Yeah.
Or even in the late 80s, you had only nothing.
Right.
You know, now at least Pixar's fantastic. DreamWorks have stepped up and they make movies that are just as good here and there.
I agree.
You know, so there's a lot of great stuff.
I have a friend that is at Pixar, and he just did a really good friend, and he just did the short they do before the movies. Mm.
Those are always great.
Yeah, he just wrote and directed and created the short for the movie, and it's called Lava.
Oh, yeah. I was going to say that's the one.
It's two volcanoes that fall in love, and he wrote the music himself on a ukulele.
What? I love that.
Pretty cool. And I don't think there's any talking. I think it's just music.
I think they released the trailer for it like last week.
Yeah, it was at the El Capitan.
Yeah, yeah.
So what's his name?
Jim Murphy.
Jim Murphy. That's cool. I'll check it out.
Yeah, I saw fantastic. Where that was announced. We put that up on the site.
Cool.
Yeah.
Grandpa Caius would be remiss if he didn't say, that sounds hot.
Nice.
Thanks.
I like it.
Thank you. Two volcanoes that fall in love.
Nice.
Thank you. Thank you, Lee, for showing up.
You know, every now and then, be remiss. Just feel.
No!
I have clearly never been remiss, and I should probably try.
No reason to start.
Pull away in your car, remissless. Not a word.
See how it sits on you. You never know.
See how it sits. See how that hair falls on your Oscar night hair.
You know, we covered three movies earlier in the show, and we never got
remember
to.
That.
But this is a time of year when they just don't know what to do with movies, so they just put a ton of them out. So there are three we didn't even talk about coming out.
Oh.
Tusk, The Skeleton Twins, and The Zero Theorem. Now, this is Kevin Smith right. directed Tusk. Skeleton Twins is Kristen Wiig and Bill Hader.
And Bill Hader. Yeah. It's supposed
and
to be
the
great.
Zero Theorem is new from Terry Gilliam.
Terry Gilliam, right. Mm-hmm.
And these are all coming out to like modest fanfare at best.
Really?
Yeah.
Zero Theorem looks interesting because a lot of critics are saying that it's the last best thing he's done in quite some time. And it's already available on demand, like on
Universe. It's getting
that's always suspicious
movies.
When that happens. Makes me curious.
Yeah.
If they don't trust it.
Like it's either really good or maybe it's like,
although
I did
see
we're losing this.
I did see The Trip to Italy and that was on demand and that's fantastic. Yeah, okay. Those movies are phenomenal. The Trip and The Trip to Italy. You've got to see them.
I like The Trip. Let me write that down.
Steve Coogan.
Got a long list going.
That's Karen's hilarious. Got her ever-growing list of stuff to see.
You're going to need a new iPhone.
But Tusk is strange, isn't it?
I will get a six.
Tusk seems too disturbing. I already don't want
to
see it.
He's trying to turn his friend into or the scientist.
Not even a friend.
It's just trying to turn some guy he caught into a walrus.
Yes.
Which is, I guess, a play on the Centipede movies.
No, actually, Adam, I think, filled us in on this when we talked about it during our writing meeting, where this is based on a Craigslist ad, I think in the UK, that basically said, I'll give you a place to live. All you have to do is dress up as a walrus for like 4 or 5 hours a day.
Whoa.
And ask no questions.
Right, and so I think this is a spinoff of what would happen if you actually responded to that ad.
No, this is Kevin Smith putting to his audience, do you want to see a movie made of this or no? That's why the poster says, hashtag,
yes.
Walrus, yes. Walrus, yes.
So nothing to do with Fleetwood Mac at all.
No. Apparently, I think it comes in at the end of the movie. Actually, I'm not
really.
I think there's some homage to it in the film.
USC gets a royalty check.
Enough people said,
of which they don't need.
Enough people said they want to see it, so he made it.
Wow. Is it
people
comedy
are messed
or?
Up.
No, it looks dark.
It's a horror. Oh, yeah, okay.
Michael Parks being all creepy.
Yeah.
You know, Justin Long getting caught in his creep
That's
web.
That's it. Yeah, okay. Justin Long.
Creep web.
Parks.
And so. I don't know how a movie with Kristen Wiig nowadays flies under the radar. But
yeah.
Right, you'd think that opened huge. I don't
Wasn't
understand.
There one other one, too, like recently?
Yeah,
last
something like
two?
In the spring.
Doesn't make sense. Yeah, because she's huge.
We previewed that one, I think, Pat. The one where she goes home.
Yeah.
Right, she gets divorced or something, goes home.
Yeah, but we can't remember the title.
That's not good.
Susan Sarandon, wasn't it? Somebody played her mother?
Oh, no, you're talking of...
Thinking of Tammy?
Tammy,
okay. Oh. But somebody did play her mother in this movie.
And on that note, we were talking about Tammy because I feel
did
that Susan... Yeah, I did, and I think that it could have been a good movie. I think they miscast Susan Sarandon because I don't think she is old and withered and unsexy enough to play her mom. And I think she did a good job, but she's just wonderful and hot and amazing. I, however, have changed my mind. I think the casting should have been Cloris Leachman.
Oh.
She would have been great because she's still virile enough and fireball-y enough to keep up with Melissa McCarthy.
Yeah.
But you get that she's an older woman.
Cloris has been playing old for years.
Yeah, and she's great at it. So I think that's where they should have gone.
She's like the young Betty White.
Yes, exactly. I was thinking Betty White, but she's too old. Yeah,
I know, exactly.
And she seems randy enough that she would, you know, drink and go down on somebody.
I think she is.
Totally still. And the young Betty White.
Wait, I also want to, before we get off, what did you see this week?
She's crazy.
I want to call out John here, who's
when he
was our guest on the show.
Let's do it.
When I was in that seat.
He's a special coach, too, and he was the guest.
So someday,
you're moving
out.
You could be here.
I know, I'm going to say. This is my goal.
See, you're playing cards right.
Wait a minute.
City goal.
Find a button and then be in that seat.
Got it.
That's right.
I can enclose things.
Right, seek that out, and then boom, you'll be in the next Avengers movie.
Have Matt suffer an unfortunate accident, and you could be in this.
Which do you like better?
Which seat's better?
Oh, I don't know. I'll tell you when I'm done with this seat. I'm enjoying you, though. I'm enjoying this seat.
More on the hot seat here.
Well, when John was here, we previewed I, Frankenstein. And on the show, he said, I'm going to go see that at midnight.
Yeah.
How was it?
It was.
Back in January.
It was as terrible as you could have possibly imagined.
No.
And I even got a little altered, shall we say, before I went to see the movie. And it was horrible because I thought it was going to be great, cheesy fun. And it made absolutely no sense. No, and it took itself too seriously. And it was actually trying to promote a war between the vampires and the gargoyles. And you're just like, but it just starts. This is what you're, and everything is narrated and handed to you. Nothing is experienced. It's all like, this is how long we've been suffering with this, and blah 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 blah. And I'm Frankenstein, and then he morphs from old Frankenstein.
I feel like
into
I should
modern.
Have popcorn when you do that.
I know, in a word.
I know, but it was so good. I was like, I'd rather watch this movie.
In a time, in an era. No, but when he moves from like old Frankenstein to modern day Frankenstein, it's literally just a morph. As he's walking.
Okay.
And then all of a sudden, he's got these two axes, and he's killing all... And it's so weird.
Like Under Armour on, or some kind of
have they just exhausted a lot of these mythological, you know, these myths or whatever you want to call it.
I think I always think it was like, you know, for
we got another Dracula next month. It's like,
Untold.
Untold. It really has something not been told.
Yeah, right.
I find that hard to believe.
Apparently.
Yeah. I don't know why I even brought this up, but there was a movie my wife and I used to love because it's horribly bad,
yes,
but good bad. And it was the first Leprechaun.
Oh, yeah.
Oh, the Leprechaun.
So
the Leprechaun.
Good bad.
Jennifer Aniston's in that.
Jennifer Aniston's in it, and he's like chasing. You know, he's always chasing people through the movie because they took his gold. He's like, "Where's me gold?" Jennifer Aniston's on the phone at one point. I think it's her or somebody else, and he's like, "Where's me gold?" And a tongue, like a fake, bad fake tongue, comes through the phone. And she's like, and then he's chasing them, and he's a little person, and they're taller. So you would think that they perhaps might have a little bit of
a
faster gait. And as they're going, they realize he's gaining on them. And you know the lore with leprechauns is they have to clean shoes and shine them.
I do not know the lore.
I got to say, Patrick, you put out your shoes and they get shine and you get like little pieces of candy or chocolate.
That's nice.
Looney Tunes.
Well, yeah. So
I'm putting out my shoes this year.
So the scene I love is that he's chasing them through the woods and they're just like, they start taking off their shoes, and he's like,
he's got to stop and shine them.
And he's got to stop and shine them, and he's still gaining on them at some point. Like, how good is with this woods? And is he on the thing at the airport where you're faster?
I like that they're keeping true to the history of the legend.
They didn't get on Dracula, is what I'm saying.
Yeah. Oh my God.
Well, that's being rebooted. Then there were six of those.
Yeah.
Leprechaun in the Hood or something.
Right, of course, yeah.
They're just, maybe they've run out. Jeez, maybe. Make up a new thing.
No, I wish I'd seen I, Leprechaun. I wish I'd seen that. That would have been a much better movie.
All right, let's wrap up the show with Karen's birthdays. Karen's weekly look at the birthdays of those who make the movies. Karen?
Let's start off this week of birthdays by wishing a very happy birthday to the lovely and talented Bill Murray.
Oh.
Yes, he turned 64, but can play anywhere from a recluse to the life of the party.
Wait a minute. Didn't he just have a birthday last year, Karen?
Yes, he did. Most recently, he was the life of the party last Saturday. He celebrated his birthday with a surprise stop-in at a South Carolina birthday party who was having a birthday with this chef that Bill Murray happens to know. So the chef said, "You want to come over? They're having a birthday party." And so he, of course, did. And when he got there, he got the crowd dancing to a little tune called Turn Down for What? Paul, let's hear a little bit of that, shall we?
Oh, sure.
Yeah. Turn down for what? Turn down for what?
And I watched the video. It's Bill Murray dancing with a bunch of 56-year-old women and sitting on them. And I got to tell you, he has a much better sport than I am because I would not like this song enough Turn Down for What, not my favorite.
It's one of those I would go for like 24, 25 seconds.
Right, and then kind of sit down.
Hey, listen,
kind
of like, okay,
listen, not touching.
I'd wait for the bridge.
Not touching.
I'm done already. Wait, what second are we on?
I was done too. I couldn't put the whole thing.
But you know, like happy, I'd be up like, because I'm happy. But Bill Murray stops in and he parties with people hard, which is another reason I love the Bill Murray.
Yeah.
So I thought to celebrate Bill Murray, we would have a game. And this game, all of you are playing and I'm going to keep score. So what I'm going to do is I'm going to read you a Bill Murray quote. And then I want you to yell out what movie it is from. Mm. Now, you don't get to keep yelling out number of movies, like every movie he's been in. Just kind of yell out one, and then if you get it wrong, then shut the hell up.
Okay,
and I'm not going to tell you who the characters are that he's talking to, because that might give it away, so I'm going to do it generally. So the first one, this is a Bill Murray movie, and the bank guard says, "What kind of clown are you?"
Quick change.
All right.
Crying on the inside kind, I guess.
There you go.
You
yeah. That's a good movie. Right.
Pat's
what
the
kind
guest.
Of clown are you?
Pat's like the guest, so he gets a point.
Come on now.
All right.
We can go halves on that.
Okay, I'll go. Okay. So
hey,
we'll
I just heard a horn. What's the next line after that?
Uh-oh.
Oh, crap. Oh. I forget
sometimes
it.
Their noses are horns.
Oh, is that what he said?
Yeah, because they're trying to decipher the audio tape, and he's like, hey, "Wait, I heard a horn in the background." Sometimes their noses are horns.
Who's the chief?
Now you got me.
Like in every scene, he's just this. I don't know what's going on. Oh, where is he? Well, then you get him. Like it was just every single shot of his. Like, he just keeps like chugging a thing of coffee, and he has to say his line.
All right, you guys are doing very well. Everybody's doing great. All right, so if you know what movie it's from before I get done with the quote, feel free to yell
out. Okay.
We'll say that now. It'll make it a little more fair. So you're going to totally get this one.
I don't like it when people come up to me after my plays and say, I really dug your message, man. Or I really dug your... Yeah.
Tootsie.
Nice.
Good job. Oh, my God. Nice. Pat's a Bill Murray fan. You're playing, I love it.
You're playing with house money, knowing the family.
Oh, that's true. Yeah. But they make, yeah, they make you watch the movies. The right.
I'm even more focused.
Phil just walks around quoting himself.
That's right, yeah. And Joel and those guys do, too. They're like, we're just quoting our brother. It's annoying, but it's what happens. All right, ready? Number three. I never liked a girl well enough to give her 12 sharp knives.
What?
Whoa. Nice.
Whoa.
No, good guess. No, no.
Oh, sharp knives.
It's more mid-80s, later than Stripes.
Oh,
not 90s.
What's the edge thing? What's the edge?
Scrooge? Outrageous.
Yeah, Scrooge. You said it.
I said it.
Got it. Oh, Paul, did you say it?
All right. I'll put P-A-U-L, because otherwise...
Otherwise, Pat will get all the points.
Paul Preston.
All right, number four. A woman says, okay, after dinner, don't put even old cheap moves on me. It's different now. And he says, oh, no. I have all new cheap moves.
Oh, no. I have all new cheap moves.
I have all new cheap moves.
Ghostbusters 2?
Yes!
Wow!
Nicely. Good guess.
I totally pulled that out because I knew it wasn't. I know it wasn't GB1, as we like to call it.
GB1, yes. GB, the original.
But it was clearly a GB line.
Right?
Yeah. So.
Mm-hmm. Next.
And they haven't made a 3 yet.
No,
so
not
I
that
deduced it was number 2.
Question number 5. Can I have another one of these with some booze in it?
Groundhog's Day.
Yes.
Dang.
That's a good one, right?
It's Groundhog Day.
Groundhog Day.
I know, that's like,
you know,
should I not give
like Kaminsky Park. It is.
Yeah. Or Illinois.
Soldier's Field.
What is Groundhog Day?
There you go.
Wait, when did he say that?
At the bar with Chris Elliott. He's like, can I get another one of these with booze in it
this time?
Oh, okay, nice.
And he's sitting there with, what's her nets? What's her face?
Andy McDowell.
She was good, man. She didn't ruin it. Okay.
She did.
Yeah, number 6.
I know her grandmother watches the show.
Uh-oh, sorry. There are 2 types of people in this world, those who like Neil Diamond and those who don't.
Ooh,
my ex-wife loves him.
What about Bob?
Yes, Paul, you're on the board.
That's my second one on the board.
Oh, well, that's what I'm saying. You're on the board twice. That's such a great... Our dog is named after Dr. Leo Marvin.
Oh, nice.
Yeah, because he's crazy.
Awesome. He is.
Yeah.
Like, don't hassle me, I'm local.
He is. Yeah. Number 7.
And he's a big city fish, but he's loving it up here. Remember that one? He's a big city fish, but he's loving it up here.
Now, Faye, for all we know, he could be the mass murderer.
Yeah.
Dreyfus is gold.
Number 7. You're on a gravy train with biscuit wheels.
Meatballs.
No, but that's hysterical. Ooh, wow. You would pick that one.
Fair guess.
This one, I'll give you a hint.
Remember Rudy was fast.
I'll let you think for a second.
Rudy the Rabbit.
Gravy
Rudy
train rabbit. With biscuit wheels. His hair is almost another character. Because his hair is so amazing in that movie that it's another character.
Wow, you are. Now you're rolling.
Okay.
I'm up. All right, so it is Paul 3, Lee 3, and Pat 2. John, can you hear? Can you hear what I'm saying? Can you hear the quotes? I'll turn up my mic. Okay, here's number 8. Okay, you'll totally get this. There's something wrong with us. Something very, very wrong with us. Seriously, something is wrong with us.
Yeah. No, wait,
we're soldiers.
Something seriously wrong with us.
All right.
Stupid.
Number 9. Now, I don't know if any of you will get this. This is quite a challenge.
Ooh.
Sorry, I get a little bit insensitive, but I'm a hitman.
Mad Dog and Glory.
Mad Dog and Glory.
No.
He was a hitman.
Limits of Control.
No.
Limits of Control.
Wow, I didn't know that.
Jim Jarmusch.
Wait. Yeah. Before we answer, Mad Dog and Glory, was that with Uma Thurman?
Yes.
Okay.
Was it?
Yeah. She played a prostitute. He played a hitman, like a mobby guy.
She played
Shivers and Milk. That's
Razor's Edge?
Razor's Edge.
No, it's one that you would not think that he was a hitman type.
Can I have the line again, please?
All right. Sorry, I get a little bit insensitive, but I'm a hitman.
Mm. Oh, Flowers. You know what? The Man Who Knew Too Little.
Yes! Because he didn't mean to be a hitman. It just sort of happened to him. Nice. That's good. Excellent deduction. Excellent. So, Pat, and so it's 1, 2, 3.
Do we need to read the scores?
3-4. Uh-oh.
I'd like to borrow
I'm just
reading
saying
the
that you guys are very close, and there's only 2 left, so you're kind of...
You skipped how many John has.
Oh, John, I'm sorry.
Let's try to get John in.
John.
Is there a final Jeopardy?
No matter what happens, you get the first guess.
Yeah, all right.
Okay.
All right, here we go.
We'll leave it.
We're going to need champagne for 250 people. And send the stuff that you send to me. Don't send the stuff that I send to other people. And this movie has been mentioned already once.
Oh, I know.
And the guy from Moving Violations.
Limits of Control.
No, not Limits of Control. And
he plays a very rich person in this.
And he doesn't like Christmas.
Scrooge.
Oh, Scrooge.
John got it. Yay. He's like, Scrooge. And lastly, okay, so this is going
to... I like
to...
the chicks line.
Which one?
Don't use that, Sifu. You work with the chicks.
Oh, God, you're so funny. All right, lastly, I think people place too much emphasis on their careers. I wish we could all live in the mountains at a high altitude.
Razor's Edge.
What?
Nope.
It's,
damn fine guess.
Live in the mountains. I can't answer because I saw it.
It's the Groundhog Day.
Yes.
How do you know?
Groundhog Day. All right, yeah.
Oh, movies got reused.
Two,
I wasn't aware.
Three,
yeah.
Four. One, two, three, four.
I would have loved
five.
The Razor's Edge, even though I've never seen
Paul
it.
Paul won by one point.
Oh.
Hey. Paul Preston.
Yes.
Winner.
Yeah, congratulations.
The winner.
Oh, Jesus. All right. We all know that Bill Murray's are very elusive and hard to find, but he's got a ton of projects coming up. He's going to be in St. Vincent, which opens October
23rd.
It looks amazing.
No, really.
Yeah.
That looks really great.
Really funny. Melissa McCarthy looks great.
And I heard it got crazy reviews.
Good.
Like in Toronto, they said it was people going nuts at how well it is.
I would love to see it in an Oscar nomination.
Me too. I'm glad to hear it.
I think I read the story about the director doing the whole 800 number thing and getting him. And he for 2 months, he called the number and left the message. And finally, Bill calls back and says, and just says, can you meet me at LAX in 2 hours?
Yeah.
And the guy's like, runs out to LAX, gets in a limo with Bill, drives out to fucking Calabasas somewhere.
Wow.
The whole time, Bill's like...
a golf course.
Golf course, and Bill's like, tell me everything about the movie. They get to the golf course, and Bill's like, all right, good. Now the guy's trapped in freaking Calabasas.
I think the car brought him.
Okay. Right. The story
but,
ended there.
That's a great problem. I would love to be trapped in a car with Bill Murray.
I gotta be honest with you, Karen. It felt a little dickish, like... You'll just follow me wherever I go.
It's Bill Murray.
If you want Uber, you can Uber back.
Take an Uber back. Just call.
I'm sure his agent would have picked him up.
Right.
She would have picked him up.
I'm sure he could have flown home after Bill Murray said he was going to do his movie. He's like, I'm flying now.
I need your collateral.
I'm fine. The Jungle Book, he'll be doing that. The voice of Baloo. He's in the Bureau.
The Scat Bear, if you will.
Mm. Ooh. Right. Do you think he'll sing?
Baloo the Scat Bear.
Do you think he'll scat?
I don't know if he sings.
But hasn't that word come to mean something else now?
Scat?
Yeah.
Are you saying
it's a crazy
person? It's dirty? What do you think?
Not that I'm aware of.
Moving on.
Scat was a type of like jazz or blues, right?
Yes, and you make up lyrics and it's kind of like gibberish.
Yeah.
He's also going to be in a ghost movie, but it's called The Bureau of Otherworldly Operations, where he's playing a voice of some character. And he's in an untitled Cameron Crowe project that's coming up. And he's in Rock the Casbah, which it looks... awesome. It's about a washed-up music producer who finds one last shot at redemption with a golden-voiced girl in Afghanistan, of all places.
Wow.
So that's kind of amazing. I think that'll be fun. And there are other celebrities that had birthdays this week. But because it's a Bill Murray week, these celebrities will never get to be on my birthday segment. So I just wanted to mention them. Happy birthday to Jason Sudeikis, Janet Pickett Smith, Jeremy Irons, Gary Cole, Stephen King, Luke Wilson, Jerry Bruckheimer, and Bowser.
Wow.
So happy birthday to all of you.
I know one of those people.
Bowser?
No, I know Jason Sudeikis.
Oh, nice.
He's a great guy.
Very funny.
George Wendt's nephew.
It's all about George Wendt.
Yes, it is today.
Yeah,
6 degrees.
Yeah, Pete Gardner was here last week. He told a story about Jason.
Pete's
a great guy.
Jason's fantastic, so good for him.
Did you say Boo Woo was coming out?
Bowser.
No, the Bureau of Otherworldly Options.
It's a Boo Woo Woo. No, it's Boo. B-O-O. Bureau of Otherworldly. That's one word.
Oh, okay.
They previewed that at Comic-Con, and I was there by myself. And if Bill Murray walked out on that stage and Karen wasn't there, she would have killed me. So thank God they just talked, hey, this is coming out. Let's get on to our next movie.
All right. And Lee, you know how much I love when celebrities sing.
People ask me, hey, what can you tell me about Karen?
Yes.
I say, she loves when celebrities sing.
Celeb singing.
Yes, I love when celebrities sing, especially Bill Murray singing. So I dug deep into his first appearance on Letterman when he came out and he sang a little Let's Get Physical by Miss Olivia Newton-John. And he barely could sing it because he was all out of breath. But it's because he's jumping around like an idiot.
You're making with conversation. I gotta handle you just right.
One of the all-time great Letterman guests.
Yeah.
But that was from SNL when he was Nick and then wherever he was.
Yeah.
Like in a ski lodge, he was Nick Powders.
Yeah.
On the train, he was Nick Rails. It was such a great gag.
Nick the lounge singer?
Yeah. Nick and then wherever he was and he would sing.
I mean, it's Star Wars thing. Come on.
Well, hey, that wraps another Showcast, everybody. Follow us on Twitter at The Movie Guys, Facebook.com/The Movie Guys, as well as YouTube, iTunes, SoundCloud, Vine, Instagram, all that stuff. Thanks to Pat Finn.
Yay!
What do you got to plug? Anything? The way to follow you, social media, website?
At that Pat Finn is Twitter, and I'm on The Middle. I just shot the first episode of The Middle
last week, and I'm going back for two more.
Nice.
That I know of so far, so hopefully I'll do.
So
a
you
bunch
know
more
Neil, right? So you just go hang out with your friends.
Yeah, it's kind of funny because Neil
cool.
and I are friends in real life, and then I'm a friend of the show, and Patricia Heaton, who's great, and everybody in the show is incredible. But it's funny because the first time we shot together, it's weird to play buddies that know each other really well and then have words to say that you wouldn't normally say.
Uh-huh.
So it was kind of like, hey, let's go down to the quarry or whatever it was. And it was a really odd give and take, and we finally come into our groove, and he's a great actor and great guy. So
you just find yourself going into bits. Wait a minute.
No, you do kind of. Or going off on your own thing. Like, what? But no, it's great. So we just did the first episode, which is really fun. And I play his buddy on the show. So
that's cool.
Hopefully I'll do a bunch more.
Cool. And thanks also to Steve Scholes for his writing contributions to the show every week. And remember, you can find everything we're up to at themovieguys.net. We'll be back next week with more man movies featuring men, including The Equalizer. So we will see you then.
Till we hit.
Happy birthday, Bill Murray.
Thanks, guys.